The Best of Barbell Show continues this week with your top five moments. That's right, you voted and we listened. Up first, we have Julian Pinot of StrongFit. If you recall this episode, we talked weaknesses, Julian found ours, and then he smashed us. Hope you enjoy it.
And left shoulder a bit. Stabilize. There it is. You're shrugging so badly on the right, see what I mean? Right there.
That right here. Right there.
It's not your shoulder.
Okay.
It's lats in here most likely.
Yeah,
it's here. Okay. But you don't have a shoulder problem, you have shoulder pain. In your case, you go like this on everything.
How do you feel that?
Yeah, you know. We're gonna start with 45 and a 25 on each side, and then we'll see where you guys are. Okay, so drag. Not too close, not too close. There we go. Wider stance, wider stance. There you go, palms up, supinated. Move. There you go, come on, move it. Keep it control. Short, 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 short. You see how he has to stand up? Because he doesn't have the hamstrings in the position. Come on. And the right arm is giving up. Sit on pull. Pull with the left, but now with the right. You can move faster, it's all good. Still go. Bit faster. Faster hands. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Oh, don't slow down. Not done yet. Come on, keep pulling. Keep pulling. There you go. But actually, I wanted to do it again because it's he dies always in the last 20 feet, but the first ones are easy. Now, don't let go on the right. Pull on the left and the right. Come on. And pull right. There we go. And the left. And the right. Good. You get downhill, so it's easy. Almost there, almost there, almost there, almost. Come on, come on, come on, come on, 10 feet, 10 feet, 10 feet, come on. Move, 10 feet, come on, 10 feet. Come on, 10 feet, almost. Push. 3, 2, 1, time. There you go. Come on, push the ground, into the ground, into the ground, into the ground, into the ground. Push the ground. So, posterior chain, see? I have to take weight off. But see the posterior chain shows. See how he wants to put his heel on the ground?
Yeah.
Not yet! Ah, video, come on, take that on video. That's the best part right there. Come on, I got you, come on, almost there. There you go. Now you can go crunch somewhere in there. Fun times!
Are you ready?
No.
All right.
Thrilling.
And we're back. We're going to be talking about plugging holes in your pyramid.
Yeah, basically. I like the way you phrase it, but yeah.
We're here with Julian, of course, and yeah.
Metaphorically speaking.
We want to talk about how is it that you identify these holes, plug them.
Yeah.
And send athletes on their way.
That was an aggressive plug. That was like,
oh, yeah.
Julian's an aggressive plugger. He doesn't like candy coated or anything like that.
We learned this firsthand today.
No lube coming from this guy.
No candy coating.
Yeah. Lived in Brazil.
We got Brazil.
Sean's going to have to bleep that out. Sorry. Yeah.
All right. So what are some of the biggest holes in the average and or elite CrossFitters game?
Okay, so in the last episode, we were talking about the critical mass. So looking through that prism, basically, what I see, the biggest issue I see in CrossFit is the planes of movement, really. Because everything in CrossFit is up and down. So I know when a CrossFitter comes here, like for example, the lats will be very strong from all the pull-ups. But in the frontal plane, so like pulling toward them is going to be fairly weak. There's no more chest activation in CrossFit. For example, it's a humongous problem because you need the chest to also stabilize your shoulders. So it's so much work
and
toward the shoulders.
And you want really cool-looking pecs.
Well,
for the
you know,
ladies.
Like the Arnold. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Well, I mean, who doesn't?
So,
but there's not a lot of benching or pressing of any kind in the same plane as the rowing. It's not really.
There's really not even even in the sagittal plane. Like all the dips are keeping now.
Oh, yeah.
They pick even on the dips. So you lock out the tricep, but there's really no chest activation in CrossFit at all. So that's a humongous hole because between the lack of rowing and now the lack of chest activation, you have the entire structure that does not stabilize the shoulder anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Like the serratus is basically very weak, if inexistent and everything. So mm-hmm. on top of all the work on the shoulder, now you have nothing stabilizing it. So that's a major issue. So a lot of things that I do is I use the decline. I don't like the bench press that much because it puts too much pressure on the pec minor, which is already overused in CrossFit. So I like to use the decline either with a bar or with dumbbells to get the chest activation going so I can stabilize those shoulders. Obviously, it has to go with a rowing because we don't want the anterior tilt. But a big, big issue that I see with CrossFitters is they have no shoulder stabilization. So they cannot stabilize overhead.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have the trap structure to stabilize their shoulder. They don't have the chest. They don't have the lats.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, you have so many shoulder injuries now in CrossFit.
Yeah, you don't have nothing. You have nothing.
Nothing is putting it in place. And again, the shoulder is a floating joint. There's nothing holding it together. So now you don't have the rear delt. You don't have the traps. You don't have the lats. And you don't have the chest. Well, mm-hmm. there you go. That's why you have
sounds like
shoulder.
A lot.
And that's why you see so
what
many.
What do you have?
Yeah. And so how many labrum tears in shoulder? How many? That's the main problem you see is shoulder now, all the time, after the Achilles.
But Julian, the bench press, especially that damn decline press, isn't that just not a very functional thing? I mean, it doesn't look as cool as all this other shit. That's when the mindset is really at play.
Yeah,
here.
And you can't put it in a Metcon, and it's not easy in a class setting to have 12 people doing decline, and it's not cool, and you don't sweat, and you don't feel like you thrash yourself. I understand all those things, but there is, again, and you don't have to do it every day, but there is a moment where the safety and health, like healthy does not seems to be very underrated in CrossFit. Let's put it this way. It's like, I'm going to thrash myself and I'll deal with the pain no matter what. And I'm like, but that's not a high level athlete's mentality. If you want to survive long enough, you're going to have to do things correctly. And being stronger means you can last longer. Like my coach is 70 years old and he still squats with
who's your coach up here?
That's my coach up there.
How much is on that bar and what is that gentleman's age?
At the time, he's 61 years old. And that is 60 years old. And that is 496 on the bar, I believe.
So a 60-year-old man squatting about 400
pounds. And by the way, he weighs
pounds.
162. So that's a triple body weight.
500-pound squat, 162, and 61 years of age.
In the gym, leading to this,
he had done
512 for a double. Yeah.
Wow.
And then that's someone who deadlifted 550 for, I don't know, 4 reps, I think. Again, he weighs 162. He's 5'5". I mean, tiny guy. And
imagine he doesn't feel like he's getting older the same way that other 60-year-olds feel like they're getting older.
He probably feels better than us.
He's 72 right now. If he came into the gym, you would give him like early 60s.
Mm-hmm. His hamstrings are quite long on all of ours, I guess.
Yeah, oh, yeah. And he has the smallest legs, but he can move.
Yeah.
I mean, and his back is strong and everything is strong. And if you look, usually strong people stay younger or longer, let's put it this way, or at least get older a lot better.
Yeah, you don't need to get put in a home if you squat triple body weight.
Exactly.
You
last a lot longer.
Well, I'd say
muscular
strength is the thing that's going to
make
determine your quality of life from, I don't know, now until you die.
Yeah, and again, this is not about being a bodybuilder. This is not about getting bigger and everything. It's just putting the right muscle in the right places. They're not always show muscle like the biceps or the chest and everything. Sometimes it can be small muscle or even toward the hammies or stuff like that. But keeping your structure strong in the right places will allow you to last. And the mentality in CrossFit right now is a short one.
And picking well-reasoned exercises to help you address those. They may be the sexiest exercise, but they are what you need to do, I guess.
Yes, and again, you don't have to do it all the time. It doesn't have to be in the MedCon. But to me, there is like a side program to CrossFit that is needed right now to compensate for the lacking, for the huge holes there is in the pyramid. We need a side, I call it whatever you want, accessory, strength program, on the side of CrossFit to plug the holes. Call it whatever you want. I don't care. But those exercises have to be done. Again, not like crazy. Only one set, once a week, but just do your due diligence.
Right.
I love your reference to the Dorian Yates principle.
Yeah.
Warm
it's
up with one set, go out for one set, move on to the next thing.
Yeah.
Just once a week. This isn't something you have to do after you work out every day.
Yeah,
just
exactly.
The once a week principle.
Yeah, that's it.
Minimally, it's like you would a medication. What is the most effective dose for you right now?
But again,
be the maximum dose.
You still have to take it seriously. Because most people will do it after the MedCon. They'll do a set of rows. I'm like, no. Because remember, there are numbers I'm looking for. I want that 50 on the rows. I want that 50% of the one rep. So you're going to have to take it seriously as a strength program. The way you look at your squatting, you're going to treat that the same way. So I want you to go out there and decline correctly, always great form, but challenge yourself to that. And that's a little bit the problem with a movement specialist is usually it's the 5 pound pink dumbbells and then they're going to teach you to move. I'm like, okay, the next stage is I'm going to make you decline 90 pound, 100 pound dumbbell and everything for 6 reps. But you're going to do it correctly, just like the mindset you had on the 5 pound dumbbell. I want you to do that with 100 pounds, doing correctly, great form, once a week, and then we move on. I mean, so you have to take it seriously. It doesn't mean you have to go crazy with it, but you do have to take it seriously.
Anybody who's struggled with movement once they got close to their snatch 1RM knows the effect of load on movement. You can't just pretend you move well if you haven't done it under load.
No.
It's like a fucking totally different thing.
Exactly. That 90% always kills you.
We've talked about supinated dumbbell or barbell rows.
Yes.
We've talked about decline dumbbell presses. What else?
Or barbell.
What other?
Yeah, I want the dumbbell rows because that's pulling in neutral.
Uh-huh.
So, and then left versus right.
Uh-huh.
So dumbbell rows is very important.
You had a number for that too, a target that.
Yeah, I want about basically, let's say, like 30% of your max deadlift on the dumbbell row.
So that's a one arm dumbbell row.
Yeah,
I think that's more than people would guess first. They'll be.
Yeah, yeah. But I've fairly high numbers. But
if you're a 200 pound guy, I could be like a 200 pound dumbbell.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. My deadlift is around 620, and I do 190 for like 5-6 reps, about around 200, so that's about right. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
And I'll give a shout out to Jim Willard, too, who years ago said one of the markers of performance, if you could grab onto a fucking heavy dumbbell, 150, 200, 250 pounds, and do those rows, if you have a grip problem, a deadlift problem, a back problem, a bench problem, doing that shit tends to fix that.
Yeah, it does.
Matt Kroc popularized that
Kroc
as well.
Matt Kroc.
And so I have the decline. The Z press with dumbbell is an important one. Mm. I mean, that's for, again, to activate the upper back correctly and things like that.
And you were talking about a percentage of jerk.
Yeah,
right?
Basically, I think the total weight on your Z press would be about like two, your jerk should be, so the max weight times 2.5 should be roughly your jerk. So if you use 130, I'll give you a 300. That's about right.
Okay.
So what kind of resistance have you gotten from CrossFit athletes for doing, quote-unquote, bodybuilding exercises?
Exactly that. The first thing I get is, I don't do bodybuilding. That's the first phrase I get. I'm like, I didn't say you should oil yourself, put a bikini,
you don't
and
need
go
a
on stage.
You don't need to get up there on with a banana hammock on your crotch.
Exactly. And then go with that, because that's bodybuilding. They don't understand. Bodybuilding is going on stage and posing.
Right.
I didn't say that. Bodybuilding is so building your muscles so they look a certain way. I didn't talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
As you said, muscle building, which is not bodybuilding.
Right.
It's not the same thing. If you have, let's say you have weak biceps, right? You do the keeping pull-ups and even strict pull-ups. They just don't build the bicep. They build your forearms. They build your back, but they don't build the bicep. Well, guess what? You're going to have to do biceps curls. Because if you don't, you're going to create, like I have a problem with my bicep. Your brachialis is going to start to give you a problem. You can get a tendinitis in your elbows really fast because you have an imbalance between your tricep and your bicep and stuff like that. Well, then go do biceps curls. Do one set a week. Jesus Christ, this isn't bodybuilding. Bodybuilding is like doing 35 sets every 3 days.
You don't have to have the plain rice and chicken breast either. None of that,
yeah,
none of that shit.
Just,
you don't have to shave your ass either.
Chill with the whole like functional movement.
Yeah.
Bullshit. A keeping pull-up is not a functional movement to build your lats.
Right.
It's not. I'm sorry, but that,
right.
I love the. I'm not saying we shouldn't do keeping pull-ups, but that idea that CrossFit only does functional movement. Bullshit. The sumo high pull is not a functional movement. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Like a sumo deadlift high pull is not a functional movement. No, so treadmill running again, is not a fucking functional movement.
Yeah, so,
I mean, not to be a dick, but fuck, man. I mean, if it is functional we're after, why are you running on a fucking treadmill for?
Yeah, and so. So again, like doing one set of bicep curl a week is not making you a bodybuilder. But so I get a lot of resistance from doing isolation work. It's like, no, they want everything to be done in a compound movement and in a med com. Mm-hmm. But I'm like, okay, look, if you were perfect physically and you would react perfectly, you could do compound movements all day and you'd be fine. But welcome to human nature. None of us is perfect and we're all going to have different way. If I make two people squat the same way, one will get a huge ass and one will get huge quads. So should I just stay there and leave them just doing the squat? No, because one, I'm going to have to go toward the quads, the other one toward the posterior chain. If I don't, create imbalance, they're going to get stuck, they're going to get hurt. I'm not doing my job as a coach. So I will deal with whatever I have to deal with whatever exercise I need to deal with. It's basically an open source like CrossFit was supposed to be. Right. CrossFit was whatever works, really. Okay, well, isolation works. And just because Glassman, being a libertarian, refused to follow the Russian path or all that stuff does not make it wrong for me to do so.
And by saying that, I don't imagine you're saying, okay, like I like isolation work, and so I'm going to do every single like shoulder raise is and every single bicep curl and every single tricep extension, every single calf raise and every single whatever.
Exactly.
You're finding the key log, as you said. You're finding the muscle that's not firing and you're isolating it on purpose
to make it fire. And then if 6 months from now we get the biceps firing and then they fire on all the other exercise, then I'll stop doing it. That's fine. But it's something that is built in you that they just don't fire properly, so we might have to continue. Maybe we don't. Maybe it was just something, a weakness that we fixed, and now we can move on. It depends on the athlete. But I will not make you do biceps curls just because it's not CrossFit. That to me is ridiculous. If you need to do something, I'll make you do that.
I guess what you're saying is there's a lot of functional movements that just aren't in CrossFit, and just because you don't see it prescribed there doesn't mean that you can't use it in your training.
And there's a lot of functional movements that are great, but they will not allow you to develop your body completely. We're not machines. It doesn't work like that. For some people, the clean and jerk is enough. Great. For other people, it won't be enough. Some people, they do clean and jerk, they get a massive back and everything. Other people just get quads and triceps. I mean, just, you know, whatever. It's just the same movement will not develop two different people the same.
Yeah.
Some people will develop imbalances here, weaknesses there. Everybody is different. And so the idea that the clean and jerk, it does everything. No, not for everybody.
Well, they make tools in all sizes and shapes and for all kinds of applications for a fucking really good reason.
Yes,
not every tool is right for every job. You can't just have one big fucking wrench in your house.
Yeah, and so that doesn't mean you shouldn't do clean and jerk. But I'm just saying the clean and jerk might be not enough for your rear delt. Yeah. So now what? So you're going to do more clean and jerk to get more rear delt. I'm like, that just it's the wrong mentality toward that. See, look, the clean and jerk is great, but in your particular case, it's not doing this. Maybe it does for you, but it's not doing for... So let's address that issue. Because your base lacks this. So I don't go into the argument with the CrossFitters because I'm like, look, you say whatever you want. Your base lacks this. Either you listen to me or you don't. But you're going to come to see me before or after surgery. It's up to you which one. So you can just keep going. You'll pop something, and then you come to me. Except now I have more work because you're even more fucked up than you were before.
But the pay more for it was a plus for you.
Yeah, well, not really, but yeah.
But so sometimes that's not worth all the fuss to deal with those problems, of course.
Yeah, and so what I do is not really fancy. It's not like it's not programming. Like my program, like Outlaw when they were like programming sends this person to the games. I'm like bullshit. There's no programming that is sending anybody to the games. If you're saying that, you're an asshole because you're selling something. It's not true. The athlete is going to put the work. The athlete has the talent, the work ethic, all that stuff necessary maybe to go to the games. And your programming is going to help. But your programming is not the one sending the athletes
Your job is only to remove the key logs.
That's all. I'm just helping. I'm plugging the hole. I'm building a better base. That's all I do. I just want to make sure that you can have you can exploit your talent and that you won't break doing so. That's it. That's it. So it's not fancy. It's not the top-level programming and all that stuff. But even the top-level programmer, that's why I'm going to work with CJ and Invictus, because it's great to have all that volume and everything. But if your base is not built correctly, the volume will break you.
Yeah, eventually in every sport, like once you get to a big level like NFL and like Major League Baseball, basketball, et cetera, like it becomes a game of recruiting. And then primarily the strength coach's job is to keep athletes healthy, to keep the best players playing.
Exactly. So just your job as a coach is, at me or those guys, is I'm going to make a good athlete and I'm going to give it to the position coach so he can make them better. So I have to give them someone that won't break, that can actually do whatever is required. So that doesn't mean specific movements. Like, unfortunately, you see a lot. Oh, it's just, I'm going to make you, my coach is to make you better at football. No. That's a football coach job to make you better at football.
Right.
My job is just to give you to him, healthy, capable, and physically capable of playing football at a high level. Then he makes you better at football.
Kind of like you develop a durable athlete, and then they make a good football player.
Football player.
Right.
But I make a better athlete.
Right.
You take, and then you make it into a football player. But if I start to train you as a football player, and then I give you to a position coach to make you a better football player, nobody took care of the athlete part. That's a problem. And that's what I see in CrossFit a lot, is like, well, we're going to do those movements. And I'm like, you need a high volume of training for CrossFit. It is what it is. But if I can't build a correct base, the high volume will break the athlete. And so that's that short-term mentality you see more and more, where the volume is getting greater and greater because the games are completely insane. And so for people to be able to handle that, they're going to need a side program to build a correct base so they can handle the volume. CrossFit is going to need an off-season. They're going to have to understand that part. You're going to need an off-season. You're going to need to heal. And you're going to need to build a correct base. And then
have a mental break from the suffering.
That too. And then so you're going to have to treat it as a sport.
What do you consider it to be now? Is there not the kind of the season, you know, March-ish through July-ish for the games competitors, and then everything else is the off-season? How do you view it right now?
There's the Killcliff has a competition in October. Okay, so you get off the games, you got August off, and then you're back in training September. That's not an off-season.
We've seen athletes compete like the next weekend afterwards.
No, but they're just insane.
So is that more to do with the individual athletes choosing to do other competitions besides?
I think that's the culture of CrossFit is still very new,
right?
And they still have that teenager mentality of, I'm just going to party hard all year, baby. So I see
it's
a competition.
It's fucking great when you're a teenager.
Sometimes in your 30s.
But and it's
extreme balance, right, coach?
And sometimes you get arrested too in the process. But it's still that mentality of that healthy is very underrated in CrossFit. And they still have that mentality of, I'm just going to bolster the wall and I'm just going to thrash my body, and I'm going to show how tough I am by doing a competition every 3 weeks, and I need to compete to get better on everything. And then, okay, and then when you...
Or every single training session is a competition.
But so great athletes get away longer with things like that. But when they break uglier than other people.
So if a coach is listening to this right now and they have athletes that have that mentality, like, how do you handle your athletes so they can kind of model after you? Do you have any suggestions?
Ask for an off season. You're going to have to take 2-3 months, at least 2-3 weeks off CrossFit. And I would like, honestly, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, whatever, but off CrossFit so we can...
That doesn't mean no training.
No.
Just means not CrossFit.
No med cons. Yeah. No, like, mentally stressing. We have to stop. It's not just the outside, it's the inside stuff. You have to stress the hormonal system all the time. The adrenaline glands require time to recover. After the games, they're shot. It's going to take 9 weeks for them to recover.
Is that mostly strength work, skill work, intervals?
Yeah, a lot of
not metcons though.
Yeah, a lot of skill work, strength work, depending on how beat up you are from the games and everything. But
trying to then push your numbers up if it's just strength work. You're just basically practicing some skill movements.
Yeah, and let's see what this year is going to be like. What do we need this year? You look at the games. So what did you lack? What do we need to work on this year? Every year you're a different athlete. You got stronger at certain things. Hopefully you got better. So now what? We move out. Do I need to? For example, last year for me was to get Val healthy. That was it. Because her shoulder was a problem, her hip was a problem. I just wanted to get her healthy. Now that I've done that, I can start to focus on certain issues like the snatch, making her a little bit stronger, a little bit explosive. But I couldn't do it as much as I wanted last year because it would have meant not taking care of her health first, which was no way for me. No matter what, even though she has a short time period, I didn't care. I told her, I'm going to fix your shoulder first. Once you can do all the CrossFit stuff without being in pain on the shoulder, then we can move on. Move safer, move better. Move faster. That's just the way it is. So move safer was, I'm going to fix the shoulder. Now that the shoulder is fixed, I can go to move better where the shoulder is in the right place. We can work on those clean and jerks. Now I can make her better at other stuff. But first, I'm going to make you healthy.
That your favorite weightlifter, your favorite strength athlete is doing this. Like, you watch Ilya and Ilya or somebody crush a world record clean and jerk at the Olympic Games. Guess what? The guys didn't do anything for about a year afterwards.
A year and a half he took off after the Olympic Games.
Off,
a year and a half.
Fucking two.
Guy was rowing. He weighed 185. When he came back to training. Oh, yeah, no, 185.
He
lost 30 pounds.
He
was just rowing every day because he's a guy that has to move all the time, so he was just rowing. He weighed 185. If Ilya Ilin can do it for a year and a half, you can do it for 8 weeks.
And guess what? Wow. He came back and fucking looked
and won the Olympics. One weight class above.
So if what would the average off season look like? I mean, we kind of said skill work, strength training, but so are they reducing how many days a week they're training?
No, because those guys like to train all the time, so you can't mentally it would not work for them. But for example, I would take one and do I need to? Is there something I need to, like, for example, at the game that we saw that is really glaring, something where you just couldn't do? Matt Fraser climbing the rope. And everything. So let's analyze that. What did you lack? There was was it like the open grip? You know, so stuff like that.
What happened for people that didn't see it?
Okay, so Matt Fraser lost the games basically on that flipping the pig rope climb workout. Flipping the pig is open hand, so I'm sure that destroyed his grip. Mm-hmm. Then he got into rope climb, and he had four to do, and the fourth he couldn't. So he tried like three, four, five times, and he had to sit. Looking at the road, not being able to climb, watching everybody else go by him. And that's basically what cost him the game. He was ahead by 100 points by then, and he ended up in second place after that workout. Why? Because his grip could not handle that supinated open hand strength. And so something like that, that would be the first thing I would look at. He said, look, we have to look at your grip and your lat engagement and stuff like that. So it would be a lot of testing on the rope pull and stuff like that, but that would be a priority. How come you couldn't deadlift those fucking kettlebells in the last, that has to be looked at. Is the problem that your grip was so bad you couldn't have a grip, or is it because you really couldn't deadlift in that, you know, with in a neutral grip with the weight by your ankles instead of in front of you? Are you so dependent on your lower back that you can only deadlift if the weight is in front of you? Can you not put your hips and deadlift in that particular position? Was that the problem, or was the grip the problem? That's what I would like to know. What gave up? Or maybe it's your head because you were already gone because you knew you lost. But yeah. I would have to look at that first, and then we're going to fix that no matter what. Then are you healthy or not? So let's fix this and everything. And so let's say he's healthy and just a grip problem. So first we fix the grip, we fix the deadlift, and then we move on from there, basically. But I would have to look at a guy like that, his first health, and then after that, what cost you? And then you start to decompose what needs to be done, and that's what the off season is for. Cardio comes back in 6 weeks, so I don't have to worry about that. But first, you're going to have to back off a little bit, especially the mentally stressing, because right now he's so stressed, that guy. I would back him off on the stress level mentally. Go hike for 3 weeks. You're not allowed to touch weight. I just want you to go hike and sleep 12 hours a day for 3 weeks. Then we're going to sit down, take a look at take a look at what happened, see why you fell where you fell, and then we're going to devise a plan to fix that. And then there's your normal training, and then we'll move from there, basically.
One last question before we go, and that is for the average CrossFitter, for the average weightlifter, somebody who's not, you know, they don't have a season, really.
Yep.
What would you tell them that they need to add to their training? We said, you know, once a week, throw in these things. Yeah. But the average person, what is it they can do to help, you know, increase their longevity?
Yeah, they will have to sacrifice, like if they train, let's say, 5 days a week and they do five main cons a week, they'll have to sacrifice at least one.
Okay.
To put, maybe once a week they can do the assistance work, depending on what they need. They can shove it in 1 day. If they can't, then you shove it in 2 days, and then you'll do your main cons only 3 times a week instead of 2. But in the long run, it will make you better. You can't get away with 5 days of med cons if you have glaring weaknesses and think you're going to get better. I know the thing that way, but the fact is it won't happen. It might take a year, might take 18 weeks, but then you're going to hit the wall, and now it's going to require more work to fix it than if you do it from the get-go. I mean, like, by the way, shoulder pain every morning, that's not normal. If it takes you 10 minutes to get out of bed and you're 28, that's not normal.
Right.
Just be honest on the issues you need to address. There is a way to do this, so don't worry. You don't have to freak out about it. But when there's an issue, address it. You have to own your training. Look, this is not working. That doesn't mean you're a pussy. That doesn't mean, you know, any of that. It just means there's an issue. Just address it.
Time to make a better decision. Is
put it down. Look at the critical mass. Look why. What are you lacking? Put that back in. And so you do it twice. Now you fix the problem. So now can you remove that or not? Can you just put it into 1 day? Can you increase the volume, but you cannot increase the intensity at the same time? So just own the training, do it nice and slow, but have like a year long period instead of that 6 weeks mentality of, oh, I'm going to kill the squat for 6 weeks. Okay, and then what?
Yeah.
I mean, have a short-term goal, but also mid-term and then the long-term, but understand that there are priorities that needs to be addressed, otherwise you will break. And stop thinking it's okay to be in pain all the time. Yeah. It's not. I mean, some pain is normal, but fix the problems first. If the pain comes from a problem that you're not addressing, it's going to get worse, not better. Yeah. That's for sure.
Actually, I have one more question for Julian. You mentioned pain. It's a good question. Shut up, jerk.
It better be good.
Yeah.
Better be good.
We've been in the pain cave. Julian, I know you go to the pain cave. When you go to your dark spots, when you're pushing that sled, when you're carrying the yoke, when you're carrying a stone or whatever, what do you say to yourself? Some things that might help other people when they're now getting used to what it's like to suffer and do it still with a smile on your face, maybe.
It's Heidegger who said you have to burn the questions.
Burn the questions.
And that's the true thing, is I'm at a stage where I don't ask myself why I'm doing it. I don't have to do anything. There's no why. I'm just going to take that weight, and I'm going to go over there with it.
Simple.
I burn the questions.
Burn the questions down,
That's the true way to be able to train and everything, is burn the questions.
Love it.
I like it. Yeah. I like it a lot, yeah.
Boom.
Thank you, Julian.
That's it.
It was a joy, man.
My pleasure.
Yeah,
my pleasure.
Thank you for coming on the show.
Yes. Okay, my pleasure.
Next up, we talk about the power of squatting every day with former coal miner, fitness model, bodybuilder, powerlifter, and businessman, Corey Gregory. Enjoy.
March in Ohio can only mean two things: bitter cold and the return of a true strength tradition. The Barbell Shrug team has ventured to Frosty Columbus, home to a multi-sport fitness event as big and bold as its legendary namesake. This is the Arnold Sports Festival, a massive four-day event that plays host to more than 50 competitions, 18,000 athletes, nearly 200,000 avid fitness fans, and of course, some of the biggest names in strength. We've come to town to give you a taste of the madness. Weightlifting, bodybuilding, strongman, CrossFit, endurance, and physique. Whatever your industry, passion, or fetish, you can find a 100-gram dose of it right here. There's no greater circus showcase of strength and fitness in the entire world. The lights are bright, the stage is set, and we are all oiled up and ready. It's time for Barbell Shrug, baby. Welcome to the Arnold.
We're back with Corey Gregory.
You know what you're doing.
Who has gone from being lean, sexy beast to big, fat powerlifter to lean, sexy beast plus powerlifter.
How did you do it?
Yeah, man. It's you know what's kind of funny is kind of when I got ripped back down, I started doing this kind of run of different magazines and stuff. I'm at 9 covers right now, which is pretty cool. My goal was 10. It's on my list.
You got me beat. I've only got 3.
Oh, man. Was it Power Magazine?
No, Muscle and Fitness, Men's Health. I was in a tattoo magazine once. That happened.
That's pretty cool.
So, I'm on 0.
So I basically got, like, pretty shredded up, and I was like, I was like, man, I got to find a way to get both of these going. And I think the CrossFit community's figured that out a lot, too. I mean, a lot of them dudes are strong as shit. Louis told me all the time there's a lot of 200-pound benchers, but a shitload of 600-pound deadlifters.
Yes.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, so, you probably aren't going to the CrossFit Games unless you deadlift over 500.
Yeah, agreed.
Probably close to six.
Yeah, yeah. I agree, 100%. All the guys I've ever messed with, they're that strong. And so my thing
they've
was—
They've also spent a period of time getting big and strong.
Yeah.
That's where people miss. They just want to do the workouts they see them doing now.
It doesn't work like that. Yeah. And so my thing was, you know what? I need to find something in the middle somewhere. And so I just bombed out of a powerlifting meet. I tried to make 81. I like cut 15 pounds. Me and Tony Ramos from Westside went down to a big meet. I've never bombed out of a meet. That's like one of the most humbling.
It sucks, man.
Dude, it's awful.
I think it's good to bomb out one time.
Yeah. No, it was good for it. Well, like, I drove 6 hours.
So you never
want to
do it ever again?
I drove 6 hours and bombed out. And so I was pissed, right? So I get home and I'm like, I'm online. I'm like, man, I got to figure this shit out. One, I want to get stronger because I obviously am weak. I just bombed out. Mm-hmm. Two, I want to be leaner because I got all these opportunities with my brand now to be on covers and do all this stuff. And so I was like, start searching online. And I found this guy named John Bros.
Yeah.
So now
John's
I'm getting
a man.
It. Yeah. Oh, that's my dude now. Mm-hmm. So just like any of these other guys, I read his article and I just reached out to him. Said, hey, man, I'm going to be in Vegas. I'd love to learn from you. And, you know, but
we'll link to that article, too. It's really good.
Yeah, the T-Nation article is the one that says, and this was my favorite thing. He goes, if somebody captured your family and said they were going to kill them unless you squatted 500 pounds, would you squat once a week or would you squat every day?
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it.
And I was like, this is my kind of guy. I'm in.
So, well, it's true. I mean,
I'd be like, I'm not squatting at all.
People look, people look at the program, right? And that's really important. But they're missing all the mental factors that if your mind controls
you
your body
it.
And your mind is underdeveloped, undertrained, and you're sitting in your fucking cushy gym, you're not at a Westside place. You're not at a place where somebody like John is just showing you what's possible.
Yep.
You cannot get that level of performance. I don't give a shit what kind of magical program you got. It's not the program. You got to have this part, too.
I hope no one's hearing this thinking, like, I'm going to do 5x5 every day. Yeah. Heavy. Seven
Not
days
that.
A week.
We're going to give you some more. We're going to give you a little bit more detail right now, probably.
Yeah,
before
absolutely.
Before you get too froggy.
So, you know, I just started looking at that. And one thing, I don't really like traditional cardio either. It drives me crazy. So I was like, my real cardio is when I'm done training, I go to the track and I lunge 400 meters. And so it helps with 400 to 800 meters. I've done up to a mile with a – I did a mile with
You've lunged for a mile?
That's –
With a 40-pound vest.
That is legit. Mm. I'll tell you what, one of my first CrossFit workouts, like back in 07, I was like, oh, I'm just going to log on to the website, do a workout, was like 400 meters lunges. And I was like, oh, that's so easy. 100 meters in.
Yeah, they smoke.
Like, the legs
I don't think it's
shaking.
Easy because to run around 400 meters for me is like, fuck, I don't want to run around the track one time. Jesus. Is there anything else I can do?
So. But I think that's all. 400 to 800 meters
so
lunges, sometimes weighted. I mean.
Yeah, I went to 3/4 of a mile with 80-pound vest. A mile
that'll
with,
build your legs.
A mile with a 40-pound vest. But 5 days a week, 400 meters, and I do like 11, 12 minutes and knee to the ground, and I'm moving, right? So I was really dedicated for about a year of that, and so it made my connective tissue really strong.
I was going to say, that's going to.
It's a lot higher
that must
up
make
thing.
Your hips feel great.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Wasn't Ronnie Coleman that's famous for doing parking lot lunges? He'd always do like 135 or 185
for like
100 meters or something like that.
He would do I see him do 185, 225 for distances. So we, you know, so I got into that and plus
I'm going to start doing it.
I call it lunge
Monday.
I'm going to call it right now. I'm going to text you Tuesday. This son of a bitch is going to pull something off a bone.
Yeah.
He's going to be hurt. As sure as the sun's going to goddamn rise tomorrow, this guy's going to be hurt tomorrow.
Yeah,
that's true.
I hashtag it Lunge University. And the reason why I call it that, because I'm either listening to guys like you, I'm listening to Robert Kiyosaki, Donald Trump. So I'm listening to my headphones while I'm lunging. Mm. So I'm getting two birds with one stone. Because I do a podcast, too, called 13 in the Prez, and I do it with Maurice Claret. And so we talk about all kinds of stuff. He's a really unique guy.
The Maurice Claret? Ohio State?
Yes, sir. That's one of my training partners.
Man, that guy's got...
He's awesome.
Mike's like, who's this athlete you speak of? Because I never watched American sports with the football.
Oh, he's a stud.
This guy's an incredible athlete. And his story is so... It's Wikipedia, that bitch.
You guys should have him on. He's awesome.
Give me his phone.
That's a done deal.
Yeah.
He'll be here today signing autographs, actually.
Oh, sweet.
So he's infamous and famous all at the same regards. You know,
I love him.
So anyway, so I said, you know what? We've been having these amazing conversations, like, and I'm not taping any of it. So we started it just a couple weeks ago, and we got great feedback. And basically, I'm giving people information to use while they're doing their lunges. So anyway, so I'm on this lunge kick. People think I'm nuts, which most of the shit I do. And it's going really well, and I'm starting – my metabolism is through the roof because of it. And so then when I come on to John's thing, I'm like, well, shit, if I start squatting every day, that should help raise my test levels. And then I lunge for conditioning – I'm like, I might just be on to something. So here my ass is every morning. I get the old school and I'm taking a squat and I go triples up to a single. It takes about 20 minutes. And I do front squat 5 times a week and back squat twice a week. And I do, and I never had a pair of Ollies before. You know, AJ Pappas from Reebok sent me a pair of Ollies, a friend of mine. And I was like, shit, let's roll. So I
It's a different world. If you've been like just in regular training shoes and you've been squatting and then you throw on weightlifting shoes for the first time, it's like, people go, should I do it? I'm like, huh?
So to Doug's point earlier, to be clear, this is – so you're building a high level of squatting skill with this. You're not just crushing yourself with sets of 5, 5, 5.
You can't do it.
You get
it.
The volume from the lighter things that are still harder shit but not beating you down.
Yep.
And then a lot of front squats, which are also a little bit easier to recover from than the back squat.
Because you're not loading up as heavy because you're not that strong.
But relatively speaking, it's hard as fuck, right?
You're
it feels maximal.
Yeah,
that's what matters.
John says you go for – what they say, a comfortable max, whichever that means, but you're going for a daily max of some type of weight.
Thing.
And what I like about him is he's like, you know, your body lies to you. And I'm like,
it does.
Well, tell me, you know, it does. He says, you know what, get to 225 and tell me how you feel. You know, like every day I walk in, I'm like, okay, day 195. And I'm like getting under the bar and I'm like, oh, I'm warming up. And then boom, PR, 350 on front squat. You're like,
that's, dude,
it happens
book,
all the time to me.
I actually like calling it the technical rep max.
Yeah, there you go. That makes
sense. Like, people, I think people will recognize when their form is breaking down before.
Absolutely.
Force through some pretty bad shit.
It's not the one I'm going to hang my spine on the platform every day.
Right.
But, you know, I have minimum weights I try to at least hit. So if I'm front squatting without a belt, I want to try to hit at least. And I do a lot of pauses I stole from Klokov. Basically, I'm a mix of everybody, dude. I pull conjugate with, Louis style twice a week. I'm doing John's everyday squat thing, but I do mostly pause work until the meet day. Yeah. And then I go back to Chuck's and go wide. That's kind of been my science.
Really?
Yeah, it works amazing. So whatever I can back squat in Ollies, I can do 100 pounds more wrapped up in Chuck's in a meet.
Really?
So I can back squat 455 in Ollies right now.
But you can use
I'm about the same.
But you use
the
other
shoe.
People need to understand
20 pounds.
People understand how important it is to make things harder. If you can squat more like that, you don't necessarily do it. You do the thing that's harder in the gym because it's going to make the other thing grow more. The great thing about this kind of training, you're not beating yourself up with volume.
Nope.
The biggest thing people don't understand is you talk about your body will lie to you.
Yeah.
Fucking really amazing book, man. I'm really impressed with The Rise of Superman.
Okay.
That book is so awesome because it talks about how much extreme sports athletes have pushed the limits because to do a massive jump, you have to align so closely with a state of flow. And you have to master that and get to that every fucking time you jump.
Yeah.
And the magic happens right on the edge. The problem with a lot of people in the gym is that they don't know how strong they could be.
Yeah.
And there are tiers of lying, actually, too. Like, I'm 300-pound squatter. I can never get to 400. You go to West Side, now you do 500. Or somebody else, maybe you do 6, 7. There's all these tiers. We got to keep looking for ways to break through.
Absolutely.
So this John's program is a great way to break the fear that it'll show you can be strong.
Oh.
That big front squat loses its ability to scare you after a while.
Oh,
right?
Dude, I mean, I'm not scared to, like, I'm going to front squat 405. I know it.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of when, 100%. Yeah. And then my goal was to be 198 in pool conventional and raw squat 600, drug-free, lifetime drug-free. And I think that would be a cool thing to do. And have some upper
abs.
So I think
not lower abs.
No,
upper
but
abs.
At least upper abs. But I think that those things in the volume, I don't do a regular leg day anymore. The volume's in the lunging.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, and I'm getting to the point, I tell my athletes, I train some NFL guys, they're friends of mine. I'm like, look, if you can go 400, 800 meters and you're not even tired, you're going to be breaking arm tackles like crazy.
If you do that, your legs are probably muscular and fit as they need to be.
Oh, dude, and they just put so much blood in your legs.
That's actually a really common thing with, especially with people in the CrossFit and weightlifting both, is there's so much just squatting, not enough lunging, period.
I agree.
And then you may not want to lunge with a lot of weight. Mm. And like what you're saying,
you don't need to. You
use
need the
it
reps.
For your conditioning. Yeah. Get that blood flowing
That's
through there.
That's what it is. Activate your glutes, activate your lower back. I mean, every time I've had lower back problems, my glutes were weak. I mean, 100%.
It's another thing Louis does a lot of is like most of the stuff he's doing is easy, light, high rep stuff. People don't realize that.
Yeah, you lift heavy for maybe 20%, and the other 80%, it's
all blood
work. It's like 8 to 15 reps at a time.
And the volume is carefully regulated. Like, Louis's not going to let you do dumb shit in there. Everything's mathematically set. So he pushes the intensity as hard as possible, knowing that you're not going to do this endless sets because you think it's going to make you better. To control the sets, and then go out and push that prowler, do wheelbarrow, the walking, the best thing is the hip squats where you just sit there and walk back and forth.
Yeah, he's
we had
big
a couple
on those
of our guys
right now.
Start
cracking
I did
pretty
that
quick.
Yesterday.
Oh, it
burns
loved
like
it.
A mother.
Yeah, I loved it.
No, it's cool. So I think that kind of set the kind of set the stage for me then to say, okay, now that I've got this kind of figured out, and then I'm doing my upper body splits, usually in the afternoon, or I'll fit them in the morning, wherever, like, which is mostly golden era type stuff. You know, I still need to look aesthetic for whatever I'm doing. And then I was like, now I got to figure out my nutrition. Now, kind of from CrossFit, I really just dropped my grains out. Mm-hmm. But I didn't limit my calories, and I've always ate kind of high fat like Mario DePasquale, but I just didn't do the loads like they kind of teach in the anabolic diet. So I really just said, you know what, I'm going to eat fruits, veggies, meat, eggs, all the basic stuff, and then when I feel like shit, I'll just have a cheat meal. But that could be a month.
Yeah.
It just depends. You know, I mean, when I'm at events like this and stuff, I'm not as careful, but,
right.
You know, so I just basically had set myself some guidelines, and as I squatted and lunged and didn't cheat as often, my weight started coming from like 95, and I'm like, I'm getting ready for this Fitness RX photo shoot that just came out as my 100. It documented my first 100 days of squats. And I usually shoot at like 170, 175. Well, I'm like 187, and I'm looking like way different. And I'm like,
damn,
oh, shit.
Got something going.
Yeah.
Here.
So I shoot at 184. Not only do I shoot at 184, I squat 405 and always in the shoot, which I was barely, if I could walk into a shoot in the old days. I mean, I'd be peeled, wow. But I was a mess.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
So here I am. Yeah. My performance is good. I'm looking good enough to still be on the cover, and I'm 14 pounds heavier than my last shoot, which is a shitload.
Mm-hmm. So
for
just
a drug-free guy.
From a lower body perspective.
It's too good to be true. Like you'd pay a lot of money to get that from a bottle.
Dude, of course, right?
You're front squatting 5 days a week, back squatting twice a week.
Yep.
Pretty heavy.
Yeah.
Low reps.
Yeah, low reps. Triples up to a single, then I go on.
So you just work up to a triple or to a single, yeah. And then you don't do drops or sets after that.
Like, now, John talks about doing back off sets. I don't really do those. That's kind of where my change is, because then I'm going to something else. So, like this morning,
so
for instance,
he wouldn't say go do 400 meters of lunges. That's
no.
Like you replace that volume, the yeah. drop sets, with
he's not
with the
adding that part to the lunges. What a lot of crossfitters make the mistake of adding things to more things. Some yeah. got to be taken out
you
with something
remove
else.
Sometimes.
That's so, like my version of it, basically.
So if someone wanted to, like, hey, I'm going to try this out.
Yeah.
You just work up to a heavy single, heavy yep. to heavy triple.
Really quickly, too. And then like 20 minutes.
20 minutes, you're moving.
And,
yeah.
and then you go do your lunges.
Yeah. Yeah,
and then,
it's not that
and then,
bad.
And then you got upper body day.
So, like, a lot of people, if they don't have to – like, I have a gym everywhere I look. So, my story's a little bit easier when that. But you got – most of the people will do lunges in the gym maybe 10 minutes and then go to their split. So if they're at 30 minutes and then they go 30 minutes on chest or back or whatever they're training that day. So the way I set it up is I go, if we pull, I'll usually stay and pull at the gym. And I'll usually, like, I had a bunch of PRs lately. I mean, I just pulled 495 standing on three mats conventional, which
nice.
Is a good pull for me. And then front squat at 375 this morning, which is a PR for me. So, I mean, I'm just, as John likes to say, I mean, I'm really crushing PRs, dude, all over the
yeah.
place. And it's been consistent. So
how many hours a day are you training?
I would say total maybe an hour and 45 minutes.
So you you're not going to the CrossFit Games. Like, those guys are having to train like 6 hours a day to stay competitive. But that's amazing.
I think
you have what most people want.
Yeah.
Strong and look good at the same
lean.
Time.
I think you can fit it in a shorter period of time, but because I have a lunch break that the whole crew's training, I take longer. But really, I think I could fit it in an hour and a half if I really had to. It's that I'm doing accessory work, extra GHD work, extra sled work, just because I can.
You do that before or after your lunges?
After. So everything. So I try to do, and I don't eat breakfast before I train either. I don't do it just because of some science thing. I just feel better when I don't eat and train.
Yeah.
So literally, I like to go in on, I take my salt, which is our product. I drink some water. Boom, I'm right in the gym, right to the squat rack. That's why one of the things I'm kind of popular for right now is my Snapchat, which I don't know if you guys are on that or not, but I get up every day.
I'm terrible at using it.
Yeah. So
that's my hardest social media to use.
Yeah, so I get up and I you know, usually try to say something motivational, and then I say, now wake your ass up and get to the gym. And then I get to the gym and, like, I got these kids hitting me up, all this stuff, and it's like I'm kind of like their alarm clock.
Yeah.
Because
I'm
up at 4 a.m. every day. So by whoever they get up, and they kind of – and I had so many kids come to the booth and say, dude, it's so motivational. I'm laying, feeling like a mess in my bed. And most of them are college kids, too, so who knows what they're getting into. And then I look at yours, and you've already – it's 2 hours later. You've already squatting. You're yelling at me to get the hell up. And it's just one of those things, like, I've kind of got into, but it's a mentality of no matter how I feel, like John says your body lies to you, man, I'm right to the rack, bro, and I'm ready to get it.
Nice.
I love it.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
Fantastic, dude. Shit.
Yeah. See, we were when you guys first talked to me, he's like, "Hey, you know, we can talk about muscle farming a little bit." I was like, "Well, we'll talk about it, but I want to talk about training."
Talk training.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, That's what I'm passionate about.
You got also thinking like, "Yeah, what can we incorporate into our experiments on ourselves?"
No, it's I'll tell you what.
I got a feeling you and I are going to be talking about training.
It's a while. Dude, it's unbelievable. I tell you what, my lower back has never physically felt this strong before. I mean, I was like a 425 conventional puller. It was awful. I pulled in chucks because that's what Louis told me to do. I was a much better sumo guy. But, you know, I put Ollie's on. I saw Dimitri.
Do you pull in Ollie's too? Oh, wow.
Okay, it makes it harder.
Well, but it does it for me, though. I feel so much faster out of the bottom like crazy. Like, it jumps off the floor for me. And it not 500 pound to jump off the floor, but like,
right.
I did 405 for 10 reps, and it just seems like it just boom, boom. I have a smoothness to it. And my stance is this close.
Frog stance.
Oh, okay.
I pull with my heels almost touching.
Wow.
It's unbelievable.
With the Olympic shoes.
With the Olympic shoes.
Or a three-quarter heel or a half-inch heel.
The full lifters. Yeah.
Wow.
That's probably the most unique thing you've said out of all of your training.
Dude,
training secrets.
So my quad, I don't know if it's because of stance.
That's what I'm thinking. This guy's got
So basically, it's like when I line up and I go to pull in them Ollies, it's like I'm working right off my VMO and just boom, and it just feels like it jumps off the ground.
Like a cold spring down
there. Yeah, that's really – when I would get in chucks – just felt like shit. I mean, I could never get comfortable. And so literally, I mean, I'll probably pull 550 at my next meet in Ollie's close stance. And I mean, it's 100 and some pound difference in my old convention.
I feel like
I want to watch him snatch now.
Yeah. Do you do any Ollie lifting?
I just started. So I just cleaned clean 275 the other day with John. I never even know how to do a hook grip. I mean, I'm really like novice.
You're novice at that. Yeah.
So John comes in and I'm like, dude, I tried to pull off or I tried to do cleans.
Is John here?
Yeah, he is.
Oh, I haven't seen him at all.
Yeah, he came by the booth yesterday. So he came in early and came.
Talk to him.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. I probably love it. He came in and he came to the Muscle Farm gym, and then he just got off the plane. I was like, dude. I was like, man, I tried to like clean 225 the other day, and I was trying to use a hook grip, and it just fell out of my hand. I'm like, I know I'm doing it wrong.
Oh, yeah.
So he comes over, and a lot of people, because I'm pretty vast in my training, they just expect me to know, but I never really mess with that world at all. So
he's a different world, man.
He's like, you know, teach me, grinding it in, and mostly this hand. And then so I take 245, and I clip it, and I'm like, pow, pop it over my head. And he's like, well, shit, dude, what's your clean max? I'm like, it's like 265. I fucking missed 275 15 times probably. He's like, you're going to – dude, I fucking smoked it. I caught it high. Yeah. And I was like, oh, shit.
I mean,
shit.
If you're deadlifting that amount, 275 clean should be easy.
So then I was like, fuck it, put 300 on.
Yeah.
And I caught it in the bottom, but I didn't have a belt on. I usually – I don't know if I should or shouldn't, but I only have a power belt. It'd probably get in the way more than anything. But I caught
yeah,
it.
It's probably – maybe this fucking guy probably cleans 400. If you just
I caught it kind of forward. I was trying to rock it back into a pause squat because I knew I could get up because I do it all the time. But I couldn't get it. So I was like, not gonna let this motherfucker go back down. But I couldn't get it through. I just missed it, but I almost did 300 the other day, which was cool.
Awesome.
It's got like perfect lifter's mentality, like, no, fuck this, I'm gonna do it. No.
Yeah, John smoked 315. Yeah. I mean, like, it was like, boom. You know, he talks in kilos. I'm not there yet, so he's like trying to add it up.
Probably like 140 kilos.
Yeah, it just smoked it, just boom, boom, fast as hell.
It's another level of discovery for it, man. Like, the next thing.
I bought some jerk blocks, dude. It's a wrap.
Oh, dude, we have dude, we have mostly weightlifting instruction.
Yeah,
like,
that's what I heard.
I'm sending you that.
No,
like,
dude,
all
I love
stuff,
it.
I think you're gonna love it.
Dude,
yeah.
I love it, and I just want to be powerful. I mean, because there's the other thing is every year about this time around, it starts to get warm out. I want to dunk a basketball again. That was like one of the most athletic things I feel like you can do. And so every time I start wanting to work on plyos and box jumps, and so, you know, I can't palm a basketball, so I'll have the guys throw me an alley-oop or whatever. But every time around this year, my kid's 9 years old. He thinks it's cool that his dad can still dunk a basketball. He don't care about the magazines anymore. He's used to that. Yeah.
You got this good total, and you're running the business. Your former core monitor. You can dunk a fucking alley-oop pass.
Yeah.
Fucking shit, dude.
But you know what's so funny is, yeah, but check
what?
This out, though.
Chris is like, what am I doing with my life?
So, let me say
you know
this.
What? Can you tell dick jokes?
No.
Fuck you, yeah. I got that.
But let me set it up, though. The reason why I think I'm like this is I was a sixth man on my basketball team. I didn't play college sports. Like, I'm athletically, I'm okay at a lot of stuff, but I'm not necessarily great at anything.
Yeah.
So that's why I've kind of like, I'm good at this stuff, you know what I mean? But I'm not, I just almost went elite. I was like, I got 4 covers shot before they came out. I was always the guy like on the outside, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like one of those things where I just kind of like do a little bit of everything.
I'm almost awesome at everything.
Yeah, that is the goal, Chris. That's the goal, baby. No, but you know what? I enjoy it and I look at it as a goal. You know, it gets me off the couch, man. Because I need to be like focused on something. And if I don't, here's where I struggle. And I think a lot of people struggle maybe this. If I don't have something set, I'm wandering, man. I don't do very good. One, I get upset with myself. Two, I'm not very productive. I mean, my low-end production is still pretty high, but, I mean, I'm just not focused, and I can't stand it. So
if you don't pick the challenge or pick the event or pick the personal, like,
I have to.
I got to do this. Yes, you plan everything off that. That's the pump
everything.
That drives your progress.
And it all starts in the gym first, and then the rest of it falls. So if I come in the gym, and I don't have to have a PR every day, but if I have my goals set up like, I want to front squat, back squat this, I want to dunk, I want to do this, and I'm working towards that, it seems like the rest of my business just flows, man, because I'm just tuned in. And then I feel like I'm doing it at 5 in the morning. If you want to compete, not compete against me in weightlifting, but in my business, you got to get a jump. You better get the hell out of bed or you're not going to catch us. I mean, we feel strong about what we're doing. Muscle Farm doesn't sleep.
And
I mean, I'm telling
you. You guys partnered with – I mean, it was cool. I mean, early in this interview – you mentioned something about like Arnold being inspiration, like when
Absolutely.
You're younger, and that was one of the reasons we're all here.
Yeah, of course.
That was because we've been coming here since 2007. It's
yep.
like we're all kids.
2002 or whatever I came out first.
Arnold was like a big piece of inspiration for all of us
and for everybody.
And, yeah, like,
first thing I ever did. First thing I ever did: concrete weights, my fingers through in my buddy's backyard. Arnold presses. The first fucking exercise I ever did. I'm like, what do I need? Giant shoulders. Well,
yeah.
Do that.
Presses.
Do that. That's how you get them.
Yeah. Absolutely.
It was so simple.
So it's like, it's funny. I mean, this guy like inspires all of us when we were younger, and we all come here.
Oh,
and we're
dude.
All doing something in fitness, and I think he's like the guy that made it real.
Oh,
like
he's
like,
such an OG.
If that guy can make a successful career yep. out of being a fitness dude,
oh,
it's like, I may not do exactly what he's doing, but he kind of paved the way.
Oh,
and it's
I only
cool
now fully
here.
Appreciate it. Dude. We all grew up watching fucking Predator, going, "Please, Lord, one day, let me fight the Predator." We
yeah.
all had that.
I
want to
be jacked in the jungle.
Yeah, but I only now appreciate that this is a guy born as a Austrian farm boy,
dude,
in a very real way.
Unreal.
I won't say nobody, but just a small farm boy.
Yeah.
And that vision to see, kind of like what you're saying, you got to see what direction you could go. And every day remind yourself that you can do it. If you're not doing the everyday reminding, strengthening your mind thing.
Out of sight, out of mind, dude.
Probably the most important reps you're going to do.
Yeah, I'll tell you what about Arnold is, what's so cool is obviously we signed a deal with Arnold, which no one thought they could ever do. And so I'll tell you the story about it. It's pretty phenomenal. So I'm literally on the golf course, which I love golf. I'm not that good at that. I'm trying to get better at it. So
but now I'm thinking, like, I know you're fucking full of shit. Yeah. Your definition of not quite good is probably.
I'm not a scratch. That's what I want to be. So let's put it that way. So anyway, I'm on a golf course, and we're in Phoenix, and it's snowing. First of all, I'm pissed because it's like this time of the year, and I'm going to Phoenix to be warm, and it's snowing. So we're sitting around, and one of our investors goes, "Hey, you think you'd want to work with Arnold?" We're all looking at each other like, the fuck are you talking about, dude?
No.
Yeah. I'm like, so how – tell me the deal. He's like, well, my sister's married to Tom Arnold, the actor. Like, how random is that? He's like, he'll call him
so
for
his
this.
Last name's Arnold, and Arnold's first name is Arnold. So
it's a wrap, dude. It's a wrap. So he says, you know, we're doing like $70 million in sales at the time. We got a lot of momentum. He's like, I'll call – you know, Tom – he puts him on the phone right there. Tom says, I'll call Arnold, see if he'll meet with you guys. So I'm thinking, oh, shit, snowing in Phoenix, which is random as hell, and we're, you know, maybe have a connection with Arnold. So they set up the meeting, and we, you know, we basically put the Arnold series together before we even met with them. I had the bottles. They look like, to us, we feel like we're Nike, and we feel like that's the Jordan brand, if you look at it like that. And if you look at the way the logo is done, that's the Jumpman, is Arnold's, you know, iconic pose. And so the branding, as you can see, we set it up like that. So I knew he would be impressed with that part because it looks gangster as hell. But the key was Arnold comes in the room, and we're in his office in Santa Monica, and it's like movie posters and a life-size Terminator, and dude, total like shell shock. Like, I'm in Arnold's office, and he's about
to
roll. Yeah. It's unbelievable, right? So I'm sitting in there, and you're just waiting on him, you know, and I wasn't really that nervous, though. And I'll tell you why, because I feel like I've been working my whole life for an opportunity like this. I'm not coming out of this room without being fucking Arnold Schwarzenegger's business partner. Because I'm not going to get this shot again. You got one chance to not, you know, drop the fucking ball, basically.
Yeah.
So Arnold rolls in and he says, you know, hello, whatever. And he goes, so why am I doing this? And he just shuts up. You're thinking, oh, fuck. The OG of all OGs just said, you know, it's time for you to. And I said, I led with this because I've always lead with training. I said, man, I'm tired of watching kids text in the gym. They don't superset. They don't know shit about the golden era. And I said, I believe that if you trust us with me, especially us with your fitness likeness, I'm gonna rejuvenate it all. I'm gonna bring back the hard training. I'm gonna teach people how to eat. We're gonna go get the files from Pumping Iron. We're gonna put them back out there.
Yeah.
I said, I think we can make some real dynamic stuff happen. And he kind of just started, I could tell I got his attention, right? And so I was doing something with bodybuilding.com at the time, and I had a trailer for this Get Swole plan that got kind of popular on bodybuilding.com. And so I was like, hey, here's kind of like some of the stuff we do. So he takes my laptop, and he's looking at it. And
I see you have some porn here.
So I go to kind of get it, and he kind of like says, sit down. I'm still watching. And I'm like, all right, cool. So he's engaged. You know, and then some of the guys said, look, we're already selling in 100 countries. They start hitting with the business, which obviously he's a businessman too.
Sure.
But he's engaged in the fitness big time. I can see it.
He's not posing. He cares a lot.
Once he's in, he's in. And so he goes, you know, he's talking. He's asking me some more questions. And then I was on the cover of Fitness RX with my kids that month randomly. It was the first time it had ever really been done. I got three of my kids hanging off of me. It was a really cool issue. One of the investors had bought it at the airport. I didn't even know. He throws it to Arnold in the middle of the meeting. And so this
the alignment of the circumstances is
unbelievable,
nuts.
Right? So Arnold looks at me and he goes, this is really cool. And he, obviously in his accent, I go, well, when you say that, it's even extra freaking cool,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So and what was really cool is he opened it up and it was all done at old school. So it's a retro 1970s gym. So he's getting the feel of
You're talking his language now.
Big time. Mm-hmm. And so you know what? He put his glasses on. He's looking through the magazine and
Arnold wears glasses?
He did at that time.
Oh,
I've never seen him do it again.
I thought he had a red mechanical eye.
Yeah, he does. He's like, so anyway,
hold on, my eye. Yeah. His fucking eye. Come on, Corey. I got to zoom in. I can't see the.
So he, you know, he's looking through it, and, you know, I can just tell I got him engaged. And he's definitely, you know, he's feeling what we're talking about. And we start hitting him with more and more business, and I could just see him feeling it. And it was just. The coolest part was he pulls out this poster. So I'm sitting from me to you, Mike, away, and pulls out a poster, and it's like a pull-out thing of an ab thing for me. And he goes, your abs kind of remind me of Frank Zane's a little bit.
You're like, holy shit. What'd you say?
That's like a compliment.
What the hell is going on in my life right now?
You really impressed me, and your abs look like Frank Zane's.
Yeah.
How do you do it?
And I was just like.
He's fucking sitting there going, my mind is fucking melting and coming out of my nose.
Yeah, it was
bleeding from the fucking nose, right?
Unbelievable.
Now?
And so, you know, once we got off that, and I think he realized, like, I could talk his language. He, you know, I do all the interviews with him. Like, he knows I know the deal on that stuff, right? And he's been like that ever since that day. The guys in the business got, you know, my partner Brad's unbelievable business guy. They got all the numbers done. Literally, we walk out of there, and I looked at Brad, and I'm like, oh, it's a wrap, dude. I think we got it. 20 minutes later, he called and said he's in. And
nice.
So that was a really cool.
Wow.
And he told us before we left, when I open my Rolodex, and it's a big one, it's serious, and I'll be in, and I'll be engaged, and I'm excited. I want to be involved in the process of the flavoring and what we put out and the training, and you can interview me, and you just tell me what you need. And it's really like that,
Holy
dude.
Holy shit, man.
He came to old school, and I interviewed him for an hour and a half. I just released it on bodybuilding.com. It's unbelievable.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I'll embed that in the show.
Actually, mm-hmm. I was checking that out the other day.
Yeah.
I saw it post up.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. It's cool. So Arnold's a G, dude. And here's what I take away from Arnold. Anytime I'm around him, your brain just goes like this. Because if you don't, you know, he's accomplished so much in his life and his vision. He talks about it constantly, creating that vision and seeing it and feeling it and knowing what it is. And I just try to follow
suit.
You're
doing every fucking day of
every
your
day,
life,
bro.
You do it.
Every
moment of it, reminding yourself what really matters to you and how you're going to get it.
Dude, 15 years ago, I was selling programs to get in.
That's not a lot of time.
Selling programs to get into Arnold.
Yeah.
I mean, I would tell people,
you're the guy at the door.
I'm the guy at the door selling programs.
And I'm like,
yeah. No, I don't want
to
buy a program for you.
Ooh, go away.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm that kid, and I'm thinking, man, I just can't wait to get in the expo after I get this free expo ticket. I mean, I could have paid $10, but I mean, I was trying to get the experience.
What year was that?
2000.
Okay. We started coming in 2007. I remember my first exposure to Expo Hall.
Oh,
I was like,
wild.
What the
I was in shock, man.
There are so many hot chicks here.
Awesome. Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that was like if you want to increase your testosterone once a year.
A lot of bad protein bars, too.
Yeah. Especially in 2007.
You got really excited and really stopped up.
Yeah.
That's what it was, unbelievable.
So, I mean, that experience was cool, man. I mean, that's why when I talked to Jim Lormer, he had no clue. When we signed up for the Diamond sponsor and just signed Arnold a couple years ago and I told him the story, he's like, ask Lucy, who's been with him forever. And she's like, I remember Corey. I remember he's like, so you got one of your starts here. I'm like, yeah, man, it was a big deal for me.
It's awesome.
It's pretty cool. Being a local guy, I mean, this is just a big deal in general. So, so it's been a wild ride, man.
Where do you see the Arnold Classic going in the next 5-10 years? Because the thing that impresses me is that this has been going on a long time.
Yeah.
And this thing just keeps getting bigger.
Yeah.
There's fencing. There's everything in here.
it's internationally.
What's the next step for this?
That's where they're growing it. Like, I'm going to Arnold, Australia next week. You know, they got Brazil. They got South Africa. They're going to Malaysia. So Arnold is a good example. Arnold says, I'm going to have the biggest event on the planet, fitness-wise. Now let's do it on every continent.
So he's are they going to have weightlifting and gymnastics at each one of these?
I think that's what they're heading towards.
And you guys may not know this, but the Arnold is actually my favorite weightlifting meet every year.
Oh, that's cool.
It's we've been coming since 2007. Most years, almost every year I've competed or coached.
Sweet.
Sometimes both.
I think it's one of the events that gave it a lot of initial more juice in the new pop culture of fitness. Like, it's coming back quickly because it got its foot back in the door here, and it was right alongside Strongman and everything else.
Yeah.
And it was a really great, well-run event every fucking year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Well, thanks for joining us.
Come on, man. I couldn't wait.
Love hearing your story.
We got this part, too. I'm still going, I could ask all this, but no.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think we're going to be talking training for...
Yeah, dude. I'll come on whenever you guys want. I've had
it. Years
from now,
baby. Yeah,
I love
this
it.
Is great, yeah.
I really, at the end of the day, like, I want people to know, like, I live and breathe the gym. I love it. It's my passion. I can't get enough of it. And I'm passionate about helping people.
Yeah.
So, like we talk about, if you follow me on social media, at Muscle Farm Prez on Instagram or Twitter, I'm leading with training. I want you to get better.
Yeah.
And that's when I see these kids come up to me and tell me their squat went up or this, the man. I love it.
Yeah, what's your Instagram? Because people need to follow your
Muscle
stuff.
Muscle Farm Prez, P-R-E-S. Both of them are. Instagram and Twitter, both.
I'll have one more. What do you tell the kid right now who's thinking, I want to so desperately be a coach? People are telling me, just get a fucking job and go to school, do whatever. But I believe in this. But they don't feel like anybody's on their corner to back them up. What's like the quickest punchy thing you say to them that they need to take away from this?
You got to find out. I really went towards my passion. I mean, 100%. But it didn't just jump right to... I think there's so much instant gratification. Like, they see rap videos, and I watch all those too, but you can't have the Bentley overnight. People don't realize it took me 15 years to get here. It is a long time, but it isn't, right?
Started with 20 bucks an hour.
Yeah, that's what
I'm
saying.
It's a lot longer than people want it to be.
They don't
want
to put the time in.
After you've done the 15 years, you go, wow, a lot happened at that time. There's no way it could have happened faster, really.
Yeah.
You see that after the fact.
I wanted it to happen faster.
But when you're the kid and you see the guy that's doing it, you go, I want that tomorrow.
Doesn't happen.
Like, you got to put in years and years,
years
and years.
I
and
didn't
lots
even,
of mistakes.
I didn't even get the Muscle Farm opportunity until I was in business for 10 years.
There you go.
That's it.
Yeah.
Plain and simple. And then
keep pushing, baby.
Here's
keep
the deal.
Pushing.
You might not even be ready for the opportunity. It comes when you're ready. And then you got to be able to recognize the situational awareness.
Yeah.
It's a big deal.
Yeah.
A big deal.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. Sometimes people, yeah. I've gotten in situations where it's like, man, I'm glad this didn't happen a year ago.
Yeah, agreed.
Because it's like, there's no way I would have been. After the situation happens, I'm like, I would not have been ready back then.
No. It's hard. Yeah. You got to keep that in mind, too, when you feel the acute heartbreak of the thing not working out now. That's a lesson that's going to fuel the next thing that needs to happen.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I appreciate the time, guys. I sort of listened to you guys lately, and I was really hyped to be on here today.
Dude, we loved having you on. It was great. We're going to have to do a part 2. There's going to be a lot of people going, no, hold on, man. Tell me more about exactly what you're doing. There's going to be some more questions.
Well, and also just give people a little bit more insight to what Muscle Farm is, that it is a griminess to it, and some people might just not know that.
Yeah. Sweet, man.
What do you do when you got a vicious case of the pre-wad poos cooking? You break out the neon. It's time for the hot tips.
Chris's hot tips for the ladies.
And the fellas.
Chris's hot tips for the ladies.
And the fellas.
What's up, everybody? Chris here. Back with edition 2.0 of my hot tips. Last week after 14.2, we got a lot of feedback that people didn't quite do as well as they thought they would do. The question is why? Well, I will tell you, look to the first priority. What was your key mistake? I would say not enough neon and perhaps not diversified enough. Look at me right now. We're going Lululemon headband, bright, neon shirt, bright, shorts, yes. Underwear, bright blue and sexy as fuck.
You're ready.
Neon orange on the shoes, the Nano 3s. For that, you're ready. Dude.
Hold on.
You.
1 sec.
You know how to silence that piece?
1 sec. Andrew Ager. Hold on. Let's see. Hello?
Hey, what's up?
Yo. Hey, we're filming a video right now.
Oh, are you guys in the 14.3?
Yeah.
Is Chris getting hot tips again?
Of course.
Filming him right now. Here he is.
What's up?
Hey, what do you think about this? Do you think it's enough tape?
You do know that's not kinesio tape, right?
What the?
Well, yeah, I figured 14.3 or so. I just really wanted to be prepared, you know?
Is that duct tape?
Yeah.
Well, I think kinesio tape might be a little more effective, but it looks like you will not be degloved. So I wish you the best of.
No?
It is very functional. I would say put it all over the shoulders and the lats as well, and maybe wrap your knees with it and put the knee sleeves over.
Just don't duct tape the smile.
Okay. Don't duct tape your smile. That's your best feature.
Thanks.
We'll chat soon. Best of luck. Crush it.
What?
Best of luck. Crush it.
Hey, see you later.
Peace. I thought Andrew made a lovely point about the kinesio tape. I don't know if there's any evidence that shit really works, but why not? I say tape it all.
There was a lot of torn hands in 14.2.
Yeah, wrap that shit all around your hands, wrap all your elbows, wrap your knees, slide your knee sleeves over your taped knees and tape the knee sleeves. Whatever you can get away with, do it. Who cares if it doesn't work or not? You'll feel like it's going
to
work.
That's another opportunity to get more neon, too.
Yeah, if you go neon, fuck.
Neon tape, neon knee sleeves.
That's two birds, one stone situation. You will crush this thing. Tip number three. We told you last week about the dangerous phenomenon that is the overhead squirt. A little more about your pre-wad poop this time. You want to make sure you got at least an hour between the last poop you're going to take before the wad and the actual wad itself. So poop. Get all warmed up.
You don't want your pre-wad jitters to turn into the pre-wad shitters.
You don't want pre-wad shitters. Yeah. It's not gonna make you nervous.
Not again. Hold on. Dude, it's Julie. Hold on. Let's answer.
Hello?
Hey. We're filming a video right now. You're on speakerphone.
I just got off the phone with Andrea. She said you guys are filming the hot chips.
Yeah, Chris is filming them right now.
Okay, I need to know. Should I wear my Nano 1.0s, 2.0s, or 3.0s?
Nano 1, 2, or 3. I guess that's really that's easy question. I guess it's 3. 3's fresh.
I would say
favorite.
Duh, 3's.
Yeah.
Come on,
3.
Julie. Duh. Thought you were a med school student. You should know these things.
Neon or the better.
Neon. Plenty of neon.
Isn't Julie lovely, folks? The only exception to that rule though, CTB, is if you got crisp new Nano 1's in the box still, you might want to break those suckers.
Yeah,
out.
Jason Kleep is actually a big fan of the 1.0's.
He prefers the 1's. Yeah. Tip number 4. Proper foam rolling technique. Obviously, if you're sore, you're a little clunky, you gotta roll out the soft tissues. But the problem with foam rolling is you lay out on the ground and you get all, you know, you gotta rouse yourself after that. You get all bored and fucking sleepy. So I would do, prop up your foam roller after you're done. Just like we're kicking a field goal, we'll go 3 steps back, we'll go 2 to the side, we're gonna plant our left foot really firm and kick the 3, 2, 1. Oh, that's a good one. What's up?
What are you doing here, Michelle?
Here's the time for the hot tip segment.
Sweet! I'm glad I made it.
We're just talking 14.3. It's very intense. We have 4 awesome tips. We need a 5th one maybe for warm-up. It's very important. Do you have any top secret tips, tactics, maneuvers you can share with our audience?
Absolutely. The warm-up's crucial.
It is very crucial.
And take it from me. I've been there. I've been to the games a few times, so I know what I'm doing.
Oh, do you now?
Yes. Do you want to hear what it is?
I do.
It's my little shuffle.
A shuffle?
Yeah. You just gotta shuffle.
I gotta see that.
You gotta shuffle like this. Boop, 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 boop. Yeah! Boop, 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 boop.
Fantastic. I gotta go. Because the sound effects are also key.
Yes. And side to side, with the leg up a little bit.
Boop, 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 boop. Yeah. Am I doing it right?
Yeah.
I feel roused already.
Yeah, you're ready.
Yeah. There's so many more tips we can share, but man, that's probably plenty. We leave you with one crucial final message. No nanos, no neon, no rep, son. You can train all you want, but if you don't eat, you're not gonna get any stronger. Coming at number 3, it's time to enter the window of gains.
Shocker, bro. We'll keep everything we just said a secret. That way they don't know.
Welcome to Barbell Shrugged. I'm Mike Bledsoe, standing here with Doug Larson, Chris Moore, CTP behind the camera. We got Charlotte behind the other camera.
Wow. Multiple cameras.
Oh, we've arrived.
Finally.
Today, we're going to be talking about post-workout nutrition. And
I've been waiting so long.
We're going to cover the food, the different types of workouts that you're doing and the different types of nutrition you might need afterwards.
The mistakes you're probably making. Or
all
could
the
be
mistakes
making.
You're making. We're going to cover all of them, tell them, let you know how dumb you are. No, we're not going to do that. So we're going to cover all that. Before we go any further, go to barbellshrug.com, sign up for the newsletter.
What if they're already on barbellshrug.com?
If you're already on barbellshrug.com, you should. What link should they click?
All of them. Test them out. See which one's your favorite.
Yeah. There's all sorts of stuff you can click on there. All kinds of knowledge. There's stuff for ebooks. There's stuff for recipes and
new
whatnot.
Article I mean, every day. Is that
depends
right?
Depends on what you want. It's there.
Yeah, whatever you want. Yeah, there's something for everybody.
Search.
Not
search.
Really.
If you don't know, just use a little search window.
It's not for everybody. It's only for you. I promise.
If you if you type in clown penis in a search box, something something different will happen. We installed an Easter egg on the side.
We now got to create like a page. The clown penis page. All right, before we lose all of our audience, we want to talk about post-workout nutrition today. Mainly because, like, I'll post not this isn't mainly, but this is why I think we should talk about it. I'll post, like, my post-workout meal to Instagram or something like that, and the people are like, oh, sweet, and then they post theirs and then tag me back in it, and I'm like...
What is that?
I'm like, that looks like about a third of what I've been eating. I'm on the gains train. I'm like, no, you're not.
It's
like,
what you would feed a 3-year-old.
Right.
Like, it's macaroni and cheese. I've got my
you're on the 2%
short milk.
Bus.
Yeah.
So, like, it's either not big enough or they
story of your
I'm
life.
I'm looking at it. Yeah. Happens a lot. It's not big enough or, like, it just has the wrong stuff on the plate. They're like, gonna totally recover. I'm like, what? What are you recovering from?
Does anyone say that? Missing a big opportunity. It's the most important meal out of probably all the meals you're gonna eat the whole day, and you have basically full permission, especially if you're gaining weight, to just fucking go off the rails and just eat whatever the hell you want. And people don't do it for some reason.
The window of gains.
The window of gains.
Once that closes, it's all over.
Yeah. Yeah. You missed the window of gains. You screwed up, man.
I don't want to be that guy.
Don't be that guy, because you might as well just start the day over. You know, just go take a shit, jump in the shower.
It's probably the most important thing you do, and it's the first thing that you overlook as you rush out of the gym to go do whatever else you had planned for the day.
Yeah. So, so we kind of covered usually they're not big enough, or they just have the wrong stuff on there. And then there's a certain amount of protein, carbs, and fat you're looking for. Probably not so much fat. What else?
You want to eat like a big bowl of country gravy after you train?
And nope. and while you're consuming your post workout meal, you need to be dancing. That's a huge.
That's how you know if you're doing it right.
That's how you know you're doing it right.
Daft Punk.
How do you know what your plate should look like, Mike? You look at all these terrible meals on Instagram. What should it look like?
It should be a lot fuller.
Like, I'm one of the typical jerks that has a empty. Fat heavy plate, because again, I like my salt milk country gravy. Maybe after I do my heavy deadlifts, what should be on there?
Mostly carbs and protein. And it needs to be this, like Doug was just saying, like it's your opportunity to eat as much as you want, probably, especially if you're trying to get big. Like, don't worry, this is not the meal that's going to make you fat, I promise. If you want to eat a ton of carbs, this is the time to do it. And the type of carbs you want to have is probably like rice, oats, quinoa, potatoes, all that kind of stuff. Ice cream. You know what? It is one way of going about it, but it's not.
I would go post.
Like,
that's after your post workout meal.
Yeah, that's. I would.
That's the dessert to your post workout meal. Not, it shouldn't be your meal.
That's not an ideal way to recover.
And
so,
only if you're trying to gain as much weight as possible.
As much weight as possible.
But actually, asterisk. That's a good opportunity for people that are trying to lose weight too. It's your opportunity to actually eat some carbohydrates.
Yeah.
Like if you're super low carb most of the day, eating, you know, borderline paleo meals where you're eating meat and veggies and a few nuts and seeds and whatever, you know, mostly protein and fat, and you're going to eat some carbohydrates, this is your opportunity. Post-workout is the best time to eat those carbs, because you're going to actually take the carbs, put them in your muscles, and you're not going to convert them to body fat. You're not going to get fat at all off those carbs. It's only going to give you more energy and help you get stronger and build muscle mass.
So if you're ever going to be
or
not
keep
afraid,
the muscle mass you already have as you lose weight.
If there's ever a time to not be afraid of getting fat, this is the one time where that definitely doesn't have to be on the table for you. You know you're going to utilize it for greater good.
And real quick, I've cut carbs out of my diet for post-workout before, just as an experiment. You know, it's like one of those things, like all the literature says – eat carbs post-workout. And I was like, okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to play around with this paleo thing. For about 30 days, I cut out all that stuff, stopped doing the post-workout shakes. And I was like, oh, I think I feel fine. I didn't really notice much of a difference. And then when I added it back in, I was like, holy shit, I feel amazing. Yeah. So it's one of those things, like, over time, you may not notice the effects of it because it's like slowly you're just getting less and less recovered, and you may not pick up on it.
It's kind of like sleep. It's like sleep, right? Some people think they have 6 hours of sleep. They go, well, I feel fine on
six. Exactly.
I know some people say eight, but I swear I feel better on six. Then when you try eight, then you see the difference.
Yeah.
Now, what about – you just mentioned a good point. But if I'm trying to lose fat, do I still maybe try to go less carb after I lift weights? Just because I think this is now the time to ask that.
It does differ. Different types of people, I think, respond a little bit differently. But I think it's still a great time to do carbs right afterwards for a few different reasons. But we can go in the science of that. But you did ask earlier, I didn't finish it. It was like, what should your plate look like? It's like half protein, half carbs.
I think so that's the easiest way to think about it.
Yeah.
Like if you just cut your plate down the middle and put meat on one side and some type of starchy, dense carbohydrates on the other side, like Mike said, like oats or rice or potatoes or what have you, that's the easiest way in my mind to know you're doing it right. Okay. In addition to dancing,
you will be dancing.
Meat on one side. Carbs on the other side.
Will you also be going, oh, God, this is a lot of food? Will that also be the way you know you're doing it right? if it seems like too much food for you, because you're probably under-eating. That's one of the big problems.
If you don't feel really tired after you eat, you probably didn't do it right. Yeah.
This is all said in the context of your whole day. Like, this is one meal out of your whole day. So if I say half meat, half dense carbohydrates, starchy, you know, carbohydrates like I just said, then we're thinking about that one meal in the context of the rest of the day. So that means that the other meals, you are eating healthy fats and you are getting fiber and whatnot through meat and vegetables and antioxidants and all the other good things that you get from fresh vegetables and fruits and whatnot. So this one meal, if you're looking at it and you're going, whoa, I don't want to like just eat protein and carbs, like what about healthy fats and what about vegetables and what about all these other good things? Well, you're going to get all that stuff, but you're going to get it at the other meals throughout your day. You're going to get it at breakfast and dinner and whatever, not in the post-workout meal.
Yeah, this is within the context, kind of setting it up, is you already eat really well. And the majority of your day, you're eating paleo-ish.
Lots of vegetables, lots of high-quality meats and fats.
Yeah, high protein, high fat.
Seeds, fruit.
Yeah, high protein, high fat, the vegetables, all that stuff. And then this is the opportunity to do, like, the denser carbs. So, Doug, can you explain the recovery side of things? Like, we're talking about post-workout nutrition, but, you know, people are like, oh, I'm supposed to do this, but why? Like, why are we doing carbohydrates and protein, and how does that work together?
Are you a friend of the fancy science stuff that goes on, like in my cells and whatnot?
Yes, on a very physiological, maybe even cellular level.
We'll talk about a little bit of that. So, in the window of gains, so if you
the window of gains,
this ridiculous term that we just made up. Check out the hashtag window of gains for the one picture that's on there.
All your gains need.
Basically, what that means is right after your workout's over, you know, you have like 30 or 60 minutes. There's no actual like definitive cutoff point, but that's typically what people say just to get you to eat right away. And during that time, say I eat a meal post workout, you know, within that 30-minute window versus waiting 2 hours. If I eat it right away in that 30-minute window versus waiting 2 hours, I'm going to take more of those carbohydrates and actually store them in my muscles as glycogen as opposed to later on where I'll store less of those carbohydrates as glycogen. If they didn't go to glycogen, that means they went somewhere else. The assumption in that case is that they got stored as body fat. So the same number of calories, the same number of carbohydrates eaten post-workout, you're going to use for good versus later on you're going to use for half good and half not so good.
So good is it's being stored in the muscles, glycogen.
Mm-hmm.
Not good is, all right, too much time's passed. Mm-hmm. And so like
you've missed the window of gains.
So, like, your insulin sensitivity,
right?
Okay, the ability for your body basically to store those carbohydrates, the sensitivity to that has gone down. And so if you wait, you know, wait 2 hours or 4 hours or however long, and you're not doing it in the window of gains, then then you're going to not have that sensitivity, and then a lesser percentage of the carbohydrates you eat are going to be going into your muscles, which is a good thing. And well, sorry. A lesser percentage isn't a good thing. The fact that they're going into your muscles is a good thing. So if you wait, a lesser percentage are going to go into your muscles, and that's not a good thing.
So
you want to eat as soon as possible.
You don't have to immediately jump off your wad and slam the shake, but you have 5, 10, 15 minutes. That should be down.
The sooner the better. Like the easiest way to handle that is just to have like what I do is I usually drink a protein shake with some carbohydrates. In my case, I just take pure dextrose, like not a proprietary blend. I just add straight up dextrose, which is glucose, just pure sugar to my workout shake. That way, during my workout, I'm getting some protein and some carbohydrates during the workout. That way, by the time post-workout shows up, already have all that flowing around in my system. It's already being digested. It's already in my bloodstream. It's already being fed to my muscles. That way, if I want to go home and make dinner, and it takes me 90 minutes to get a meal, that's really meal number two.
Yeah.
Like I'm just eating again. The post workout, excuse me, the during workout shake kind of makes up for the fact that I'm not going to be able to eat an actual meal right away when I get done training. That means I don't have to bring food with me to the gym, which is kind of nice.
But so, for the person who's doing WODs or crazy Metcons and they're not going to drink a shake during, just right after is cool.
Well, first of all, I'd encourage them to drink a shake during. And if you don't want to drink it during your Metcon, you don't necessarily have to. Some people don't really tolerate.
You're not drinking a milkshake during. Doug, what is in that shake exactly? Because it's a light, not very rich.
Well, here, let's finish this. So.
Then Steve's going to call you a pussy for stopping to go get your drink. Oh, yeah, trying to catch your breath, aren't you there, Tom?
So what you'd want to do in that case is either drink your shake like right before, where you're not actually in the Metcon when you're drinking the shake. That way, during your warm-up, during your strength work, you're drinking your shake. And then by the time the Metcon comes, you already have something, again, kind of in your system. That way, during the Metcon, you don't have to take a break and, like, go get a drink of your shake. Especially if it's a short Metcon. If it's 15 minutes, you don't need to, like, stop and get a drink.
Unless you will
survive.
I will have to refuel to stave off death 5 minutes into whatever I'm doing.
Right.
Yeah, I got 30 good reps in the tank, Coach, and I got to refuel. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, you always got to consider that if you eat something, it's going to take, 30 to 90 minutes for it to, like, really kind of start to get into your system. So if you drink a shake right before your workout, that means, if you only have a one-hour workout, really it's really just getting into your system right about the time that you're finishing your workout. And so as a post-workout shake, that's pretty ideal, really. It's like it doesn't have to take an extra 30 or 60 minutes to start digesting. It's already available for your muscles right then and there.
Yeah, so your timing is even better.
Yeah, so for me, I don't really do a post-workout shake specifically. I drink a shake during my workout, and then I eat as soon as possible right after my workout.
How soon into it do you start drinking it? Is the whole time you lightly sip the same shake?
Yeah, right about the time I start warming up, I just start drinking my shake. And then by the time I'm about halfway done through my strength work, usually my shake's gone. And then that's kind of nice, too, because by the time I actually get to my post-workout meal, there's been an hour and a half in between where I didn't drink a shake, finish it, and then try to go eat a meal. There's been some time where I've gotten hungry and there's some room in my stomach.
That might really help the people who afterwards they really struggle with even getting a shakedown, even getting a light plate of food. Mm-hmm. Some people, the appetite is just not there.
Yeah, for me, like, I like doing the shake during, like, the strength work, warm-up, strength work. And then once, like, for 5 minutes before a conditioning session, I just switch to water.
It gives your stomach a chance to clear.
I need to be feeling nice and light and clean. And then immediately after that, I drink a little more water, but then I switch back over to, like, a post-workout shake for sure.
Yeah, and actually, on that note with mentioning water, I like to drink my workout shake and then the rest of my workout crush a bunch of water. That way, when I get to my post-workout meal, I'm not thirsty. Mm-hmm. And I don't have to drink a bunch of water that don't have any calories.
Right.
I can just use all the room in my stomach for a massive meal where water's not getting in the way, so to speak.
So we want sugar. Dextrose is one form. There's different supplements out there that have some carbohydrate in them. What I find is a lot of times they just don't have enough. So buying like a big tub of dextrose can be really helpful.
Yeah, go to Now Nutrition. The big orange containers that you see like on Amazon.
Those things are clutch, man. Yeah. All their line, right?
Like a 10-pound thing of dextrose is like, I don't know, like, I don't even remember. It's $20 or something like
right.
that. It's really cheap. It'll last you an incredibly long time.
It's actually cheaper on bodybuilding.com. Not plugging, just saying.
Okay.
We'll find the greatest deal, and we'll link it to you, folks.
But it's probably the best source of sugar that you could get. It's pure glucose. As far as sugar goes, it's probably like the healthiest sugar you could be eating. It's not a
slippery slope, Doug. Slippery slope.
Every other variation of sugar is not quite as good for you as glucose. Not saying it's like a healthy thing necessarily long term if you crush it all day long, but post workout, glucose is probably the best sugar that you're going to want to consume as a during workout shake sugar.
Does it depend? So for me, I vary the carbohydrates in my drink depending on the type of workout. If I'm just doing strength work, well, I guess we can
You mean the amount?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we can talk about ratios a little bit. So like if I'm doing like strength work, I'm looking at like sometimes like a 1-to-1 or a 2-to-1 ratio of carbs to protein because I'm not burning up a lot of glycogen. Like when I'm doing a lot of strength
work. How
much
do you know to put in there, like grams wise? You use a scoop
for Oh, yeah, I mean, the scoopers have...
Like 30 grams or whatever.
I use a 40-gram scooper, and so, like, I can, like, just say, okay, it's half full or a third, you know, two-thirds or whatever. Like,
you don't have to be extremely precise with these measurements.
I'm not weighing anything, but I do have a scooper that's 40 grams, and so I can kind of... I do 40 grams of protein, and then I do another 40 grams of dextrose or something like that. but, like, if I'm doing just strength work and I'm keeping it under sets of five and the volume's relatively low, I do, like, a 1-to-1 to 2-to-1 ratio of carbs to protein. Mm. But the moment you start getting a longer endurance type workouts where you're working out for hours on end, that might shift a little bit on if it's more of a conditioning workout. If you start to do hero wads, you might want to add maybe a 3-to-1 ratio of carbs to protein.
Mm-hmm. 2-to-1 is probably still okay if you're average wad where you just need some extra carbohydrate. You're doing more than squatting, but you're not doing anything too crazy. You're your average CrossFitter doing the workout of the day.
Yeah. So the amount of reps you're doing, you know, that would be your volume, could dictate how much sugar is actually in your drink or carbohydrate. And then we didn't really cover what the protein does. So we're talking about like post-workout nutrition. It's all about recovery. It's about feeling good after you work out and then prepping for the next workout, even if it's the next day or 2 days later. Like the faster you recover, the better. And the more you recover, like the sooner we're talking about the window of gains, the sooner you take advantage of that, of your post-workout nutrition, the higher you're actually going to get in your recovery on both glycogen reuptake and then also with protein synthesis. You want to get into like, Doug, you want to get into like what the protein is actually for during the workout and then after as well. Because you're talking about sipping on protein during, and there's something that happens there too.
Sipping on that protein.
sipping on the sip.
The two main things there, if you're having sugar and protein during your workout, and or post-workout, they're similar, but I tend to want to gravitate towards a during-workout shake and then a post-workout actual meal.
Yeah.
In that case, you're going to break down less protein. You're going to break down less muscle mass. You're going to get less sore.
Your muscles are made of protein.
Yeah, your muscles are made of protein. There you go. So you're going to break down less, and you're going to probably build more. So if this is baseline.
And by the way, we learned from Dr. Andy Galpin that you don't have to break down muscle to build it up.
Totally unnecessary.
So, like, you don't have to.
So trying to minimize the breakdown is actually a really good thing.
Yeah. As an example, if you are here at baseline, you break down some muscle mass and you dig yourself into this big hole, it might take you 4 or 5 days to come out of that. If you have a good amount of protein and carbohydrates during your workout and right after your workout, then maybe you don't dig yourself into quite as deep of a hole, and maybe you're fully recovered a day early, which means you can go train again. And so the difference between, you know, taking 4 days to recover or 3 days to recover is a lot.
Especially if you add it up.
Over the course of your life,
oh God,
that's a lot.
There's a difference between you being an advanced, awesome athlete and still being at the bottom of the whiteboard. To add up all that cumulative better quality of work and better feeding over the course of just 1 year, your body looks completely different. Everything's different.
Over the course of a year, you know, I'm not even going to attempt to run the math on that, but you're going to get dozens of more workouts. And so that's so many more opportunities to gain a little bit more strength. In that example, if you put on, you know, an extra pound on your back squat every single workout, well, if that's dozens of workouts and each workout's worth a pound, well, that's an extra 30 pounds you put on your back squat simply because you recovered better, and this is a major factor into helping you do that.
That's a good thing.
Are you saying that the window of gains can lead to a lifetime of gains? As Usher and Little John once said.
Well, the powerful part.
Eat in the window. To the wall.
Eat it all.
Till the sweat drops down your balls. Eat.
That's the other thing we say is there's all the good scientific reasons why you'll feel better and feel better recovered. But then there's just the habit of if you're thinking about how you can quickly give energy back into your body after working out, then that habit is what's really, really powerful. That stacks up. I mean, course of a year, you're going to be a lot different because of that.
Yeah, I like to think about workouts as practice. You know, you ever you ever hear about like the 10,000 hours, you know, when someone accumulates that 10,000 hours, then they kind of master that task or something like that.
Yeah, you always said it with squats, right? The person who squats more than you has done more squatting than you. They just found a way to get the work done. Now your job is to find a way to get the work done. It's going to take some while to catch up to that.
Right.
The same thing as nutrition. Like, it's not that you had something magical today that you added to your protein shake. It's that for now a couple years, the habit and the ritual is you think a lot about how much calories you need and when you're going to do them and how to match that with the amount of effort you're putting out. So that's the thing that has a really good impact on your body. Well, transformational impact on your body.
Yeah. And I do. Go ahead, Doug. You were going to make a point.
I was going to touch on something that we brought up earlier when you were talking about ratios of carbs and proteins and how much to get and all
that.
The easiest way, I think, for me to figure out how much how many carbohydrates, how many grams of protein someone needs, and then I'll convert it out of grams here in a minute, is for a strength athlete where you're getting that kind of 2-to-1 carbs to protein, which is I think is a good ratio for most strength athletes, about 20% of your own body weight. So if I'm a 200-pound guy, 20% of my body weight is 40. If I get about 40 grams of protein, and then since it's 2-to-1, I could double that. So that would be 80 grams of carbohydrates. That's kind of the minimum for me as a strength athlete that I would want to get post-workout. So 40 grams of protein, 80 grams of carbohydrates. You know, that's shy of 500 calories. That's probably the minimum.
Yeah.
You could certainly go beyond that. And yeah. if you're talking about, you know, protein powders and whatnot, you know, depending on your scooper, you can just look at it. That's a scoop or two, depending on the size of your scooper. You don't have to, like, measure this in any fancy way. Just eyeball it and just take a big scoop and put it on there.
Whatever grams is not gonna make a big deal.
Yeah, the most important thing is that you did something. You ate something. That's the most important
thing.
The difference between nothing and a big pile is an enormous difference. Okay, you just want to make sure that you get a big pile of food in some capacity. That's really the big thing. Have I ever gotten exactly 40 grams? Probably not.
That John Bro's way of saying it, if you tried, it was a plus. If you didn't fucking try at all, negative. Start again. Do better. Next time.
Yeah, so you don't have to hit those numbers exactly right. Just make sure that you're getting something post-workout.
You find that most people underdo it once, even after they listen to this episode, they're going to think, oh, I'm going to go do the window of gains. And then they still, like, lowball it.
Certainly if they're trying to gain weight.
Scared of carbs.
Certainly if they're trying to gain weight, it's more common to underdo it than to overdo it. Like, you should think, holy shit, I'm about to make myself so fat when you're trying to gain weight. Until you get the hang of it, once you've like gained a bunch of weight a couple of times for whatever reason, and then you've maybe leaned back down and then you've gained some weight again, and you're good at that, and you're kind of a professional at gaining and losing weight for whatever reason. You know, like, I used to weightlift and I would gain weight for weightlifting, and then I would fight MMA and I would lose back down so I could have my fight, and then I would gain weight for weightlifting, and I would bounce back and forth all the time, and eventually you get good at making those adaptations. You don't have to eat so much food like you feel like you're going to get fat, because you know how much food it's going to take and you know that you're not going to get fat. Likewise, you know how much food that you're going to have to not eat to lose weight without losing all your muscle mass. And eventually you'll get good at it. But initially, especially if you're trying to gain weight, you probably should feel like I'm eating too much food.
Yeah.
If you feel like you're eating too much, you're probably doing it right.
And that's a great way to guide it, is if you feel that emotion, you're probably getting to where you haven't been. And because you are feeling uncomfortable, now you're getting something done.
Yeah, right.
You should be outside your comfort zone.
Yeah, you should be outside your comfort zone.
That means you're doing it right.
Yeah.
If I'm trying to maintain, or if I'm not trying to put on too much fluff, I adjust my carbohydrates by, like, how much fat I'm putting. Like, first off, I've been doing it long enough. If I do a big, long conditioning session, I know I need more carbs. If I do a strength work, I need fewer carbs. And then I can kind of track the trend over time by – I just look in the mirror. You could get fancy and do calipers or something like that, but I can go, oh, I'm not as lean as I was 2 weeks ago. I should probably cut the carbs back post-workout. Mm. Or if I'm starting to get too lean, and – what I mean by that is, like, I start getting too lean, and I can tell that my...
Tell us what it's like to be too lean.
If I start getting too damn lean, well, here's what I do for that problem. Well, you're saying something important. Like,
well, what I'm saying is, like, there's a level... When I start getting too lean, my performance goes down. Mm-hmm. And I know that. I know that, like, when I get to a certain point...
You probably stop having your period, too, don't you?
Well, your hormones do take a shit when you get too lean.
Get too lean, like,
that's the Melissa Etheridge window of gains.
Now you just know you're not recovering enough, though. Like, if you start getting leaner, it's like, okay, my recovery's not as good, but I might be liking the way I look better. And so I think that's a good way to adjust the carbohydrates. So even if you're trying to be leaner, it's good to do the carbs afterwards, but you need to be tracking what happens. And if you're doing too many carbs, you might be getting fluffy, so you just need
to
keep backing it off.
You're asking people to do a thing that's actually really tough to do, and that is, you know, my dad told me to do that one time. I asked him when I was a kid, like, do you think I should, like, do this? I was feeling fat, like 10 years old. He told me, just look in the mirror. You like what you see, you're okay. If you don't, well, and he left it hanging there. I go, oh. I thought that life lesson up. If you don't like what you see in a mirror, or if you see changes, good or bad, that's your first indicator. You got to get comfortable with looking at yourself. If you can't look at yourself, it seems like another problem that's going to displace these other worries you have in the gym. You have to be comfortable doing that first and paying attention to what's happening with your form.
That is quite a bit of a tangent, but I kind of want to talk about it.
I'm good at
another
tangents.
Tangent. No, I mean, like, for all of our for Muscle Gain Challenge, and then for our barbell shred and barbell bikini, we ask people to take photos of themselves. Like, oh,
our, this is a big. I want to fire it up. It's a huge thing to
and,
do,
and it's not barrier. For us. It's for the individual. Mm-hmm. Like, you got to be comfortable looking at yourself and then making a judgment, I guess. But like, you go, hey, am I going the right direction or not? And a lot of times, people go, oh, I don't feel like I'm getting any better. It's like, do you have any objective data? It's like, well, no, I didn't collect any because I was embarrassed. Because
the way you feel is not because, that accurate, you know?
Right? Yeah, exactly. So it's like, if you need to take a photo before, photo after. You can do, you know, body fat testing or something like that. But a lot of times people want to get leaner. If you're not measuring, and measuring can be just taking a picture, putting it up, and comparing it to last month or 6 months ago or something like that. Mm. If you're not doing that, then you have no idea what's going on. And the only reason we're tuned in, and it's easy for me to go, oh, I know if I'm getting leaner or not, is because I've been watching it for 18 years. I've been paying attention to what's going on. As I eat different types of food, as I train differently.
I think it's just like when Doug said, if you're not, if you feel like you're doing too much, that's a good sign that you've broken through a pattern and you're doing something new. And if you know the numbers and you know what you should be hitting, then you can be reassured you're in a good spot. If you pair that with, I'm not comfortable looking at myself and watching closely what's changing, but now I break that. Now I'm just in the routine of paying attention. I know what my weight is. I know how I'm looking. I can see that I'm slightly different, but in a good way. I can reassure myself that I'm right on track every day. You start doing all this, now you got your shit nailed down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know all the data. You know what's going on. You will not be surprised by one day waking up being bigger, smaller, weaker, whatever than you thought you'd be. You're on your shit. This is what you should be doing. Now, these are key habits.
I used to graph my weight in Excel, so I always knew if I was gaining or losing, especially when I was doing the bouncing back and forth between weightlifting, where I was competing either at 85 kilo or 94 kilo, depending on how far along I was in the process of gaining weight, and then losing weight back down to fight at 170. So that's a big swing from 94 kilos, which is 207, down to 170. I'll go back and forth probably a couple times a year in some cases. But now what I do is on my iPhone – if you click on the health app.
And if you're on iTunes, you are not seeing
this. You're not seeing this. You have a health,
imagine your mind
a health app on your iTunes that comes with your iPhone. Just click on health data, body measurements, weight, and then add data point. And then just plug in your weight. It timestamps it, and then it automatically graphs it for you.
Wow.
I didn't know it did that.
It couldn't be easier.
Dude, yeah.
I got to add that.
I'm going to use that for a week, and then I'm going to fall out of the habit.
And then you can see, like, it'll graph it over the course of your week. And then you can click on month, over the course of your month, over the course of your year. And it just tells you automatically, like where your weight is going, and it does it for you. It's super easy.
I'll include that in the notes, too, because that's a really handy tool. I'm sure there's something else that'll do it for you on Android or whatever.
I've evolved to the point where, like, I just go off of how much my wife wants me. That's how I adjust my nutrition.
You brought through all this science and all these years of training
experience. There's many factors there.
Does my wife think I'm hot or not? Let me guess what the answer is. In your mind, you think it's always, oh, yeah,
she's trying
to jump
my bones all the time.
Well, I guess you're doing just fine. You're hyper lean enough, right? Is that what
that's
it
right,
is?
Yeah.
Speaking of graphs, though, I feel like your wow when he showed that was like way fucking overdone. Like he just showed you like the new Tesla or something.
It's because you don't have to think about it.
You can chart your weight on a fucking iPhone.
Whoa! Well, it's because it's dummy proof. If you can just type in the code to get into the phone, you can track your body weight.
It's pretty automatic. Like, it's not – you don't have to set anything up. I mean, I don't know.
Say wow again.
Whoa!
I don't have to do anything. Wow!
All right, with that, we're going to take a break, and we come back. Yeah, we'll figure out how much.
Those are going to be some awesome questions answered, I think.
How much Doug's
Oh, yeah, we got a bunch of questions from Instagram. We're going to answer at the end
of the
show.
We're actually going to answer questions. We tried to do this early, like back in episode 5 or something like that.
We don't have time
for the questions.
It took us 173 pilot tries.
177.
This is 178.
After episode 5.
Oh, yeah, I did reference 5.
Okay, we're back in a minute.
Oh, quick math.
Hello out there. We're about ready to begin our program. It's a beautiful day, and we're going to have a wonderful time this afternoon. I want to acknowledge the presence of the man. He's been referred to as the chairman of the board of all the blues singers. He's been called the man. But whatever we call him, I know him to be just a fine, warm human being full of humility. Would you please come forth, Mr. King?
Thank you. after another one of those crazy dreams. Oh, nothing is going right this morning. The whole world is wrong, it seems. Oh, I guess it's the chains that bind me. I can't shake or lose these chains and things. Seems like everything is lost. I got a cold-hearted, wrongdoing woman and a slave-driving boss. I can't lose these chains that bind me. Can't shake or lose these chains in me.
Now, next up on the top five, our longtime good buddy and resident research geek, Dr. Andy Galpin, is here to blow your mind with science.
Before the show started, we were all bullshitting out here in the backyard.
Shocking. It was like 2 hours of pregame for this episode of the podcast. Yeah.
And we just started talking about different things, and we were like, oh man, we should just turn this into a myth-busting episode.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know, I'll kick it off with one of the ones, and this really isn't a myth buster, but people go, oh, you know, I don't take it because I'm not trying to put on weight right now. I'm like,
supposed to cycle on and off, bro? How are you supposed to cycle off, bro?
You know, so easiest way to think about it is this. There are four macronutrients, carbohydrate, fat, protein, alcohol, right?
Yeah,
which we're drinking.
The easiest way to think about creatine is it is a fifth macronutrient. Okay, it's not right, but it makes you think of it that way. So I always ask students, do you cycle on and off protein? Do you cycle on and off fat? Then you don't need to cycle on and off creatine.
Having more substrate around is a good thing.
Yeah, carbohydrate causes you to store excess water.
Mm-hmm.
If creatine, okay, let's talk biochemistry. Let's have an argument over it maybe. In the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Carbohydrate does the same thing, arguably more. So whether or not you're taking, it's such a bad understanding of what the purpose of creatine is.
What is the purpose of creatine?
I don't know what it is.
Yeah, so it's really effective for about everything. In fact, there is more work going on in creatine in Parkinson's patients, in cognitive function, in neurological disorders, than there are in strength, power, muscle building. People have stopped asking that question since we were asking that question 15 years ago.
Yeah, I mean, I asked it in eighth grade while I was taking creatine for the first time.
Yeah, it's that well known. We've just stopped asking questions. And the clinical significance of creatine supplementation is just... it's extraordinary. It's really, really promising.
So
stuff.
It does wonders for mental acuity and for people who might have brain and neurological issues.
Yeah.
What about for strength?
I actually put creatine in the health portion of my classes for that reason.
The performance.
No, because we know the performance questions. It's
answered fucking 15, 20 years ago.
And we wrote a review on that in 2000.
Yeah.
We do, but everyone doesn't. Just state the obvious for a second and tell us what creatine's
for.
It's
very, very, very effective. It's very effective.
It's dirt fucking cheap.
Yeah.
It's almost free.
So
we are going to get this out of him.
All right. So what does creatine do for performance athletes?
So the easiest way to think about it is the way that you make energy in your muscle. All right, you make this molecule called ATP. Think of it this way. Whenever you break a bond, it gives off energy, right?
Like a relationship bond.
Yeah,
like
any bond. Doesn't matter. Bond. Doesn't matter. Yeah. It gives off energy, right?
Yeah, it does.
So there's this molecule called ATP. Most people have an idea what that is. It breaks apart, gives you energy. Creatine is very effective at resynthesizing ATP so you can re-break it and get more energy. It happens to be the easiest chemistry way to get it.
It allows you to fuck more shit up.
Yeah, so it allows you to make energy really, really, really fast. So for strength and power movements, it allows you to do a few more reps or at a little bit faster and more frequently.
If you do that every session, you do it month to month and year to year, all of a sudden you've done 10 times more work.
It'll make you maximally strong and maximally fast for a few extra seconds. If you can go at max 100% full speed or max 100% full strength for a full 6 seconds, maybe it'll stretch it out to 7 or 8 seconds.
Yeah, so, or think of an example if you're going to do a lot of really heavy sets. So you're going to do 5 or 10 sets of 1 or 2. Maybe it gets you another set.
Yeah,
which is adding to cumulative work.
Yeah, I tell
time.
People it's not what you do in any one time. If today you're just X percent better, it's one little fucking sliver better because you took creatine.
Right. So
over the
majority,
course of 5 years, you're fucking obese.
So the majority of the research again years ago showed for strength and power development, it's very effective.
Right. So as an example of what you just said, if you're doing a 95% snatch every minute on the minute. Maybe normally you could do 3 or 4 sets before you start missing number 5, missing number 6.
Yeah.
Well, maybe if you take creatine, you can hit number 5 and hit number 6, and then you miss 7, 8, 9.
Exactly.
So recovering in between repeated bouts of heavy or fast movements, it'll let you go for a little longer.
And here's
so snatch ladders, clean ladders for CrossFitters, that's a fucking awesome supplement.
Yeah, and it's actually what people don't appreciate about creatine is it's actually what they call an intracellular buffer.
That's
so it's actually going to... think of it this way. It's going to block the accumulation of acid. So it's actually very effective for endurance.
We're
going to
go down that route, too?
We can get
there. Do it. Go.
That route.
Oh, we got to finish all the creatine benefits first,
This is the biggest
Doug.
Myth bust of all.
Yeah.
Hold on, Doug.
Okay. No. It's like a dual one right there.
Okay.
We can run down the muscle and the lactate one.
Let's okay, we'll do that.
Do it. Go.
So what do you want to do, muscle or
lactate? Finish creatine.
So here's the creatine. A lot of people assume that acid is causing fatigue, and it's just not. It's not how it happens, but it's not helpful. So actually, creatine works as a very good buffer for acid. So it's very good for a short anaerobic, 2-3 minute, a minute, 30 seconds as hard
so
as you can.
So we're doing Fran.
Like yeah.
Creatine is going to help your Fran.
Yeah, and so that's the probably unappreciated aspect of it.
Yeah.
Especially the clinical stuff we also talked about.
So it helps with power output.
Yeah.
And it helps with mental acuity.
Yeah.
So if you're a CrossFitting rocket scientist, is there any downfall to taking creatine?
It's really, really cheap. It's really effective.
Okay.
And
no real
so
side
no
effects
real
at all.
Risks
so what's whatsoever. The negative side effects of creatine?
So the slide in my class that shows up says, here are all the negative side effects. You ready? Next slide. that's
and,
it.
And yet, there are journalists that have written negative side effects, right?
I saw one in the British newspaper like 2 months ago.
Not scientists.
So journalists. Yeah, exactly. So here's the deal. And people always cite, I read this in the paper. I read this. Entire football team gets compartment syndrome, or it makes you bloat. So let's talk about what's happening.
It's 115 degrees outside, and we did way too much. That had nothing to do with it. It was the creatine, you son of a
bitch.
Andy, we got to get our guys tough.
Or the entire football team is juicing, and that's way more likely to cause.
Or they're all hungover.
It's not the creatine.
Yeah.
It's not the creatine.
Andy, let's answer this question. The practical thing for the audience. Okay, I should get powerful. I should extend my maximum power and all that shit. What should I do, coach? How much does that take? When? What's your expert opinion on dosage?
So the basic idea is somewhere in the neighborhood of 0.03 grams
that
per kilogram.
Precise.
It usually rounds out being about 3 grams to 5 grams for a 170-pound person, something in the neighborhood. I would never suggest calculating it. Just 3, 4, 5 grams.
What about 100 grams? Is that better, coach?
Yeah, take a scoop.
So most creatine bottles have a 5-gram scoop.
Yeah,
and if you take too much, what can happen?
Well,
what dangers lurk in our creatine bottles?
Well, what do you mean by too much?
I mean, if you are supposed to take 3 grams and you take 5,
doesn't
what's
matter.
The worst thing that can happen?
No. They've actually done up to tenfold. It's not that big a deal.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go obnoxious.
Probably shit your pants, I imagine.
I mean, you may not have heard this, but there's some speculation that creatine does cause a little bit of myostatin inhibition.
Oh, geez.
Don't even get me started.
Just real quick, but there's a theory that if you were to take up to 60 grams a day the day, like spaced out, that it would...
Let me tell you where that theory is not coming from. It's not coming from people that are measuring myostatin, I can tell you that. Nobody that does that work is saying that. No.
Oh, man. I can't wait. I can't wait for the comments.
All right, so let's go down the buffering track.
Yeah.
So tell us about lactic acid and what's correct about that and what's not correct about that.
So almost nothing is correct about lactic acid. That is common acknowledged.
So what's the theory, first of all,
so
and then you can bust
can I,
it.
Tell us all about the bullshit
Let me go back to 1880 or so, Germany.
1880?
Let me tell you kids a story.
Oh, shit.
I want to tell you guys how
I'm so glad it's going this far back.
So this is what happens when you drink scotch and you're a real science nerd. You look these stuff up, and you end up buying paperbacks on Amazon for $3 that went out of publish 100 years ago. Anyways, the original work on lactate came from deer stags. So,
sounds hot.
A stag, yeah. They hunted. What they realized is when we kill a stag and it's been hunted, there's a lot more lactate in the muscle. All right, it's been sprinting for its life. Therefore, lactate must be causing fatigue.
And that's what
120 years later, we still have that same idea, even though 60 years of science has showed us quite the opposite. In fact, lactate is probably the single most preferred fuel source in your body. If I IV'd you right now, put glucose or sugar in one of your arms and put lactate in the other, your body would pick lactate as a fuel. Not only does it not cause fatigue, it's an incredibly powerful form of sugar. That's essentially what it is. It's one step away from sugar. And your body much prefers that. There's a guy just down the road, actually.
So how do we produce lactate?
Can you put all that in a pill form? I'll take it.
Yeah.
Inject it in my arm.
So I'll make this real simple for you. Sugar is six carbons. When you go through this process called glycolysis or splitting sugar, it gets broke into two separate three-carbon molecules. We call those pyruvate. Pyruvic acid. Remember this stuff?
Now, yeah. I remember when I was younger taking pyruvate for this reason, but then is that effective?
No.
Okay. Go.
Close. So now we're at 2 3-carbon molecules. We want to metabolize or break those bonds, like I talked about earlier, to get energy. Well, if I don't have enough oxygen to send these 3-carbon molecules down the road through metabolism, there's actually hydrogen floating around. And so I bind a hydrogen to that 3-carbon molecule. That is lactate. It's pyruvate with a hydrogen on it. That's all it is. So in fact, what lactate is, it's a pyruvate that is held, because if you're not familiar, hydrogen is acid. That's what pH, potential hydrogen, right? So lactate actually is pyruvate that is holding on to acid. It's stopping you from becoming acidic. So the more lactate you have, the more you are stopping yourself from becoming acidic.
That's the point. It's capturing it.
And so the easy way to think about it is, and I ask my students, okay, so if you could think of one thing in the world, you had all this H plus floating around, what do you think of that binds really well, and you don't have to know chemistry to know this answer, what binds really well to hydrogen?
Oxygen.
And makes?
Water.
Water. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. So now I've got pyruvate with a hydrogen attached to it, and I want to get back to pyruvate because pyruvate's sugar, right? Think of it that way. What am I going to do? I'm going to take a big, huge, deep breath and bring in
oxygen.
Right. Fantastic. I'll bind that oxygen to that hydrogen. I make water, and then I send my pyruvate through as in metabolism. So lactate actually is a fuel. It gets sent to your heart, actually. It gets sent to other muscle. It gets sent to the liver. It's a fuel, and it's blocking you from becoming acidic. Mm-hmm. It's tremendously important. Why the mistake? Is there a correlation between fatigue and lactate? Of course.
I was laughing because some asshole killed a deer and came up with this whole thing that we all just buy as undisputable fucking training truth.
Well, you know how I learned this lesson? Actually, fun story. During my doctorate, we had to take our comprehensive exams, and one of the guys on my list was a guy named Paritesh, who's one of these original researchers, right? Did bodybuilding, fiber typing years ago. Mm-hmm. And his question was, you have 8 hours, tell me about lactate. And I was like, okay, filled like 30 minutes, and I was done. And I got a huge lecture for him about all this stuff, and go back and find this, go back and find this. You don't understand lactate. Yeah. You're going to have a doctorate in bioenergetics. You don't understand this single most misunderstood ion or enzyme.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. Well, lesson learned.
So go back and read.
Learned.
So instead of calling it lactic acidosis or whatever, a lot of people call it metabolic acidosis because it's more technically correct. So when people discuss doing lactate intervals or something like that, where that uses that term, like, what's the correct way to talk about all that? How do you use it when you're talking to athletes?
Well, here's the easy way to think about it. In the end, it doesn't matter. Call it whatever you want. As long as you're communicating what you want your athlete to do, it doesn't really matter if you have the right terminology. So you can call it lactate. It's the same thing, putting yourself in a state of really high lactate. Mm. Well, that's actually happening. It's just not the cause of fatigue. So call it lactate. Mm. That's why I always laugh when people call it Metcon, right? That's the CrossFit term.
Metabolic.
I always want to respond, can you explain to me a type of conditioning that's not metabolic? It's all metabolic conditioning.
Just might be a different metabolic pathway.
Yeah, and
but they're usually referring
cool,
to
Andy, okay. It sounds fucking cool.
It's not
and that's
even
why
a different.
Like it.
It's not even a different pathway. It's
you know,
the same
you don't have
one.
To have evidence for everything, Andy. Yeah, okay, right? Not everything has to be in your fucking scientific ivory tower. We like the word Metcon, dude. We like the fucking word Metcon, okay? And wad.
I don't
we like to blow our wad. Okay, is that so bad? Is that fucking bad with you?
I don't jazz people back. It doesn't matter. Like, again, as long as you're communicating with your athlete, it doesn't matter.
So what's causing the fatigue?
So that's a great question. We have no idea. No idea. There's some ideas.
That's a sign of somebody who's telling you the truth.
Yeah.
When you ask them a question, they go, I don't know.
Well, we certainly know this. Enzymes, those are the things that make energy. They don't work when they're in really acidic environments. Great example. You guys make guac, right? Of course, there's some right over there.
Oh, God.
Guac. You take your avocado, you cut it in half, open it up, right? And it's what's the main macronutrient in avocados?
Fat.
Fat. Okay,
delicious,
what happens?
Fucking delicious fat.
Yeah. What happens when you put oxygen around fat?
Oxidation.
Same thing happens in here. That's happening on the avocado. It's literally the same process. It's being oxidized. It's radical oxidant. It's oxidative stress. That's all the same word. Okay. So what do you do to make your guacamole not turn brown?
Pour delicious lime juice all over that shit, homie.
And what's lime juice?
Citric acid.
Enzymes don't work in acid. So if I put your muscle in acid, it doesn't metabolize your fat. If I put your guacamole in acid, it doesn't metabolize that fat either. It's literally the same thing.
So how do we metabolize fat? What's the most effective way to metabolize
fat? So I shouldn't inject lemon juice.
You should inject lemon juice. I actually get asked that question a lot. What if I drink lemon juice all day? I'm like, fantastic. It doesn't.
What's wrong with you? That's what you have. What's wrong with you, kid?
I don't care.
Oh, you're a weirdo, man.
Just eat it. It doesn't matter. So you're not the... And so what's causing fatigue is the question. Acidosis does not help.
Right. I was saying, Dr. Andy said never eat citrus fruit.
Right, there are other things that, with the way that the muscle works. So remember that ATP molecule I told you? There's a thing that suggests that maybe that phosphate, so it gets broken into ATP, which is triphosphate, into diphosphate, and one more phosphate. There's an idea that that one additional phosphate, or energetic phosphate, causes fatigue. There's a bunch of ideas, but the real answer is we really, really don't know what's exactly happening. There's an idea that it's actually central. So the neurological system is shutting you down before muscle actually wants to shut down.
Protection.
Yeah, whatever.
Would that be, you know, what people call CNS fatigue?
Oh, my God. Don't get me... That's a worse one than lactate.
We're going...
Oh, my God, another myth.
Let's do it. I was throwing it at you. Go for it.
Yeah, no, it's... there is no question that the neurological system can sort of get overwhelmed and shut down.
What is CNS fatigue? Explain that briefly. Like, what do people think it is?
So the basic idea
before
is...
Before we bust it, we got to say what it is.
Is that the central nervous system can be trained independently.
What's the central nervous system?
So that would be basically your brain.
What is your brain?
The spinal cord and the spinal cord and your brainstem.
Your nerves run into your muscles and tell them what to do.
It gets frustrating sometimes when people come to me and go, "Oh, I was experiencing too much CNS fatigue."
Yeah.
And I go,
"That's because they read that shit on a blog."
I'm like, I saw what you did for training. You didn't suffer from CNS fatigue.
No.
If you were in nature, you'd be fucking dead in 2 seconds
exactly.
And would be through with you.
There's
Evolution
no,
would take you out with that
and
talk.
There's no question that the spine and the brain will sort of fatigue in that fashion. But muscles getting a whole lot of fatigue there, too. The basic idea that irritates me is people think you can train your spinal cord or your brain to fatigue, but your muscle's completely fine. And that those things can be trained independently. That there's a central nerve. It's not my muscle, it's my central nervous system. Wow, take intro physiology class. There is no central nervous system training that trains muscle differently than it trains central nervous system. You got fatigued, fantastic. There's no difference there. Again, it's one of those things I just go roll my eyes when coaches say it. As long as you're communicating the right message, I don't care if you understand the physiology, if you're programming.
It does make me wonder sometimes whether coaches are using that terminology to explain
absolutely.
To athletes, knowing that it's not the exact right thing.
Well, they probably don't, but who cares?
It sounds sexy, and I guess as long as they get it, no harm, no foul.
No, I mean, you get the idea of and I won't mention a name here, but a friend of ours I remember one day was like, it was an off day. And he was like, "Oh, I'm just going to do a bunch of really heavy deadlifts. Just train the central nervous system so my muscle's fine tomorrow." And I was like, "Whoa!
Repeat that.
You do heavy deadlifts so you don't train your muscles?"
No. That is not how it works.
Have you deadlifted before?
Yeah, that is not how it works.
I usually get really sore.
Yeah, that's not there. And then the other one was the muscle.
Yeah, is
muscle
talk about that. We don't know why people get tired. Is it because we're too fucking jacked, Andy?
Well, this happens a lot with MMA fighters and boxers. And they actually believed it at one time with baseball players, and that's, you know.
It sounds like the muscle-bound argument.
Like, if you look,
it's
out of that asinine.
All you got to do is go back to, the 70s and 80s, and baseball players want to lift weights, and the coaches are like, no, you'll get too muscle-bound, but Barry Bonds fucking nails home runs. And
why are steroids important? Why would you even do it?
It's
to hit dingers. Why would you want it?
It's the fatigue thing that Doug and I were talking about earlier, that the idea that if you get too much muscle, well, you're going to get tired faster. And, that's such, a very bad understanding of how physiology works on any level. The idea that having too much muscle is bad. What'd you say earlier? Really? Watch the CrossFit games.
Yeah. Those dudes are buff as shit, and they have amazing work capacity, and they're mobile.
Yeah.
The shooting holes in all those arguments. I feel like people watch MMA, and they see this one dude who happens to be buff, and he happens also to be out of shape, and then they say because he has muscle, he's out of shape.
One fucking guy bench presses too much before a fight.
It
ruins it for everybody.
I'll give you a great example. Jake Ellenberger, one of the guys I work closest with. He is, his biggest professional issue is you know, he gets a little bit tired. He's had some fatigue issues, and he's really, really, really muscular. Mm-hmm. He's unbelievably powerful. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, man, all this muscle. Like, man, you just don't get it. We were talking earlier. I'll give you three arguments on this. Number one, just look at the athletes. Look at a George St. Pierre. Look at a Sean Sherk. Mm-hmm. Arguably two of the fittest
guys. Sean Sherk is like the jackest dude.
They're so unbelievably jacked, but they never get tired because they train that way, because they're genetically different that way.
Bob Sapp gets tired because he's huge, because he's just huge. He doesn't fucking work out.
And he doesn't
he's not
train.
Conditioning.
Yeah, he doesn't train.
You can be strong as shit and muscular, but also do your conditioning,
The
man.
Problem is these guys are big and they fatigue quickly because all their training goes towards getting big. And none of it has to do with endurance.
That's the fucking problem.
That's the problem. That's
training is imbalanced.
And you think of it this way. So, without making math too crazy, take an athlete who's 6'5", right? And they're 200 pounds.
Asia Barto. Well, he's heavier than that.
6'5", 200. So say they have 150 pounds of muscle on their body, just to make numbers easy. Now if I take somebody, instead of making them 6'5", make them 5'8", put the same numbers on them, they both still have 150 pounds of muscle. But why is it we look at the 5'5" guy and, oh, you're too muscle-bound, you're going to get tired? He's got the same amount of muscle as that guy. He's just distributed it differently.
He's just hard to take down.
Yeah, like it doesn't make any sense. In addition, the last comment I'll make on that is, any idea where at in your body metabolism or the way that you produce energy, do you know where that physically happens at?
I'm going to guess the muscles.
It's in muscle, yeah. So if you want to produce some energy, you need muscle mass.
And plus, it still does that force stuff.
Well, you get the argument. Well, look at the endurance athletes. You never see a super buff endurance athlete.
They train like shit.
They also run a bajillion hours a week, well, and they don't eat, and they don't train, and they're genetically really, really good at that.
None of them are strength training for hours on end every week. They touch it a little bit.
And you have a nature-nurture issue there where the really high-level ones are really good at that. Because they've been built to have a certain mass to tendon stiffness ratio. You know, they're able to produce a whole lot of force with very little energy to get there. So it's just a really silly argument.
Wait, how does that work? That's something we don't talk about very much on the show at all.
Yeah, so
we do talk about stiffness, actually, just not tendon stiffness.
I'm so stiff right now.
This is one of the issues we worked with the UFC guys on a lot.
Yeah, we don't talk about Snap, to give you a Mark Verstegen.
Yeah, right? Pop Bank, yeah, whatever he does. The issue is there's a lot of ways to produce. So in my lab, we study muscle at the single cell level. So we pull one muscle fiber. We take a biopsy. In fact, I've taken a biopsy of Mike.
Your first muscle biopsy.
How was his touch? Was his touch gentle?
Well, his tissue resembled something of an older woman. Something like that. But we take.
He had to take two out because he didn't get the first one in. I was like, no, Andy, you got to push more this way. Yeah.
No, I remember the needle's like halfway in, and I'm like, I think I'm there. And he's like, you're not in. And I'm like,
I can feel how many years
I've been waiting for you to tell me that I'm in.
Because it's that weird like pressure, like, oh, yeah. Like not a pain, but like, oh, God, what is that?
And I remember for some reason I'm looking at his face and not looking at his leg that I'm jamming this gigantic needle
as you
in.
Go, satisfying, and like, last push into the hole.
You're not in. You're in. All right.
Snap it and get the fuck out.
But we study muscle one cell at a time.
Petted him after. Is it okay? You want to try again? Or?
So we publish all this research on what happens on one cell at a time, and then people make these extrapolations to whole muscle performance. Right. And we're like, whoa. Like, there's a lot more in muscle than one cell. There's the connective tissue. There's the connective tissue around the entire muscle. There's the tendon and ligament. And one of the things that we do with the MMA guys is we try to test and tease out their muscle force versus their tendon and elastic response, because they're different. So somebody can be really, really strong but poor elastic. I'll give you an easy example of how we do that. Mm-hmm. So I'll make them do a vertical jump from a static squat position. Mm. So I'm going to take the tendon and elastic component out of it, no counter movement, start from a half squat straight up. And then they get to do a counter movement. They get a dip and drive. And then I make them do the same thing off of a box. In fact, I got this from old...
this is my researcher Shaz is doing.
Yeah, old stuff from Bud Charniga.
Yeah.
His old translated stuff on their numbers. Oh, yeah. And the old Russians, what the numbers should be. And we use that, and so you jump off of a box, and now we're looking at how you land and go back up. So now it's really elastically driven. And we want to look at, and shocking enough, a lot of these guys produced a tremendous amount of force, jumped really, really high from a static position. But when I had them give a counter movement, they didn't jump any higher. Which you should jump higher. And so my immediate reaction is we got to work on more reactive, explosive stuff.
That's my weakness, too. I can sit down the bottom. like on a low box and jump, and then not really jump that much better. You know, yeah. That's why it's one of the things that it'll make me perform better is just doing more of the reversing.
And how funny it is, my whole life, so I was a competitive weightlifter, and my always sort of joke was me is, if I couldn't front squat something, I would just clean it and then try to front squat it.
Yeah.
Because I could clean almost as much.
I tell people that sometimes. I'm like, yeah, I actually know a guy that can clean more than he can front squat. And they're like,
and it took
power clean or clean? I was like, clean.
Yeah. And it took this dumb draft years to figure out, like, when I was working with these guys actually, and I went, maybe I should do some more pause squatting because I am very bad at producing force. I rely entirely on my elastic response.
That's why box squatting is good, too.
Exactly. And so now I started doing that stuff, and wow, the gap got much better. But that's how we use sort of the idea that there's a lot of things producing force that are outside.
Your mommy, the research, that's the last time I did research. Yeah.
But it's how you can use research and science to actually help performance a little bit. So some of these, we had them doing a little bit more, and we're just talking not like a 24-inch box jump, you know, like off of a 4-inch or 6-inch thing, landing and going. Mm-hmm. And in their sport, it's sort of like, okay, imagine a guy's pressing you in the cage. You got to back up a few steps and then lunge back at him. You can't do that right now because you get sort of stuck in the hole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You got no elastic. We did that, and now their lives, I mean,
the
a week.
Speed is really important. Like when I did my thesis, one thing I did, I borrowed Louis Simmons weight releasers. I went up there and trained for a week. I said, hey, dude, I'm doing my thesis. You mind if I take your equipment out of here and just never come back? That's the kind of guy, that's why anybody talks shit about Lou, I go, look, okay, you can have your ideas, but the guy is so kind. Like, he just let me take his shit and go back to Memphis. Did a study where we did jump squats. So you lowered a certain percentage of your max. These weight releases would hit the ground, and the weight pops off the barbell, and you just fucking jump. We had this awesome thing. I wrote a little thing, and I got money from the NSCA wearing a T-shirt. God bless those guys. What the fuck are they doing now? They gave me a couple grand. I bought a
getting sued.
What was that thing?
Oh, shit. Right?
What was that thing we bought?
Oh,
Andy?
I've been in some fun meetings with the NSCA.
What was that thing we bought? It's a barbell suspended in an apparatus where if you let go of the barbell, the circuit opens, and the bar. The thing catches the bar, so you can jump with weight and land with your body weight. It's really cool. Mm-hmm. What we found is it didn't matter how much weight you added to the bar. We thought, well, these things, people use this shit. What's going on? You lower the weight, it kicks off, and you jump. But really, that didn't matter. What mattered was the speed at which you lower. You get down quicker to stretch things.
And that's the part that irritates me whenever I work with my students that are coaches or other coaches. They're like, well, you know, we just did this, actually. I had a John Cronin from New Zealand up in our lab.
I almost went to work with him, man.
Yeah, and he had visited Cal, and he went to Stanford and all these other places. Then he came down to us, and he was like, you guys are the first people that are actually using any semblance of science, because he went up there and he's like, the coaches were like, well, you know, we're coaches, we're not researchers, we don't read that shit.
Bullshit, dude.
And he was like, and I was like, well, this is how we're doing it, we're trying to, you know, and there's tough, and you can't be both for sure, but you can't just pass off the researchers, wow, this is, ugh, they don't know what the fuck, they're all the researchers, boy, they've never lifted before, they don't know. Like, yes, we have. We're trying to do shit.
That guy was barking about, hey, you know, get out there with your lactate and your goddamn central nervous system fatigue. Like that's what they go do. Like, it'd be helpful if you learn the evidence. It'd be very good for you if you learn something.
I mean, you gotta let the evidence build up over time too.
Absolutely.
The other mistake, because the other side of the coin is people find one study and they, you know, that one, like you're looking at that one cell or something and they extrapolate it out to the entire human body.
Yeah.
Yeah. So on and so forth. So there's got to be that happy medium.
No,
it's good to look at the research. You know, if there's been 60 studies done on this thing and all in agreement and, you know, it's been peer reviewed and all that, then that's good. But, you know, but on the flip side, you know, people take single studies, take it way too far. So there's got to be, you got to be smart about how you read, you know.
Yeah. It's the edifice. It's the edifice. You got to wait for a wall to be built of information before you can really make it. Exactly. You take one thing, you get, okay, maybe there's something here, but you wait until there's really. But then you still have to be very, very, very careful about taking a basic single cell or whatever, oxidative stress, and applying it to the human condition. There's a big, big, big jump there.
Well, also, if you're not a researcher, but you are very experienced and you understand research, then you don't necessarily have to read the part of the research where they're interpreting the data. Not that you can't read it, but you don't necessarily have to read it. You can read like the methods and the results and look at the data, and then with your own experience and intelligence, you can interpret the data however you see fit. You say, oh, I understand why that happened like that. Oh, that makes sense about what I've been doing, what I've seen in the world.
Read the methods, because
if you only have a little method, don't read the abstract conclusion.
You have to look at the actual data. You don't just read the abstract, and you don't just look at what the researcher wrote as the conclusion. Mm-hmm. You have to do it yourself if you really want to know what's going on.
Yeah, that conclusion might have some bias.
I published a paper 3 or 4 years ago called Guiding Coaches Through Science.
Yeah.
And it was for coaches. And the idea was that.
You're like Carl Sagan.
Can we get that? Can we get that link? We need to have that link off of our blog.
We'll put it in the show notes.
Yeah, we'll put in the show notes on the website.
You know what? My first piece of advice: what to do with the introduction? Throw it away. Don't read it. It's not information. Methods.
It's what you do so you can start talking about what matters. Yeah. You got to do this awkward rambling.
You're trying to sell.
You pick 10 random articles. You reference them. You throw something together that works. Yeah. You're trying to.
Well, for us, it's grant money. We're trying to convince people to fund our work.
Yeah.
So it's not for you guys to read.
Don't read the intro.
If you are brand new and you don't know shit about that paper, then you can read the intro because it'll fill you in. But if you're experienced and you already have a lot of intelligence about that area, then you can probably skip it.
But be careful because the intro is guided. I'm trying to convince you why you should read my paper. I'm not giving you like the full unabashed, here's all the stuff, here's the pro. Yeah. I'm giving you
it's not unbiased.
It's a sales pitch. Yeah. It's a sales pitch.
It's selective referencing.
Read the methods, and there are certain parts you just throw out, don't read. Read these few results, here's how to get to them. And then the discussion, just like you said, throw it out too. Because this is speculation. I think it maybe happened because of this. I think it happened because of that. Maybe this happened. Hell, I don't know.
Who knows?
Yeah.
But so don't read that shit. Exactly what you said. Read the
methods,
results.
Data.
You make your decision. Boom, out.
Yeah.
By page two of your discussion, you're like, what else can I say about this shit?
You have to research, and you don't take, like you said, you don't take that one paper and be like, okay, that's it. I'm now going to take X.
Right.
Whoa.
Come on, athletes. Let's jump off the cliff.
That actually happens the most with supplements.
Oh,
you know,
God.
They're like, there's one study, and then they want to take, I mean, that's what I do. But
you took that liver, the lizard shit after that.
And it works, but you know.
Deer antler piss and.
Yeah.
I read the study. Should I be taking deer antler? What?
Yeah, one or two studies doesn't really do it. We were talking about creatine earlier. There's been fucking hundreds, 700s, 1,000.
Creatine and caffeine.
Caffeine, yeah.
Go to examine.com and go, oh shit.
The numbers are in the tens of thousands on that. Tens of thousands.
There's a preponderance of evidence. We know what the fuck we're talking about when it comes to caffeine.
That's why I kind of roll my eyes when you said it. I'm like, do we really want to take time talking about this shit?
Because people are listening to journalists, and that's a problem.
Yeah, it's not for us. It's for
get off
whoever happens
dick.
To be listening.
Yeah, it's...
Three, two, one.
This week on Barbell Shrugged, we visit the Human Performance Labs at Cal State Fullerton to discuss the latest sports science with our longtime friend, Dr. Andy Galpin. This is one of the top educational programs in the country, with multiple teaching, research, and training spaces filled with some of the brightest minds in strength and conditioning. And while you don't know them all by name yet, their work will likely influence the way you train and coach at some point in the very near future. As you can tell by the goggles and lab coats, we came prepared to handle some serious knowledge bombs on this episode. So be warned, things could get a little geeky.
Welcome back to this very sciencey episode of the show, everybody. We have a few more really cool things to share science story-wise, but before we do that, Dr. Andy Galpin, you're going to tell us how this field of sports science and kinesiology is kind of rapidly experiencing some big change.
Yeah.
Tell us more about that, man.
I think it's really important that people, not scientists, understand what's actually happening in the field, especially young people in this field, young coaches, even if I don't even mean young by age, but new in the field. Mm-hmm. There's things happening right in front of their eyes that I don't think they're necessarily aware of.
Mm-hmm.
So if we sort of track the history of the entire field of strength and conditioning, we'll call it, it really started in Stockholm, Sweden, at GIH, which is essentially the first fundamental starting of the study of movement. Right? It literally started with gymnastics.
Mm-hmm.
It evolved. So we're talking late 1800s, around the early turn of the century. It evolves kind of a big jump into the Harvard Fatigue Lab. Right, which is in the early 1930s or so, where they started studying fatigue and human performance. And they weren't doing it so that they could make sports better, right? Because sports weren't really necessarily popular then. They were doing it really for things like industry.
Labor force,
right? Why are people getting so tired? How can we help them recover better? And so we're trying to understand fatigue.
Mm-hmm. So cool. It's a building block stage first. The characteristics of human movement and then what makes people tired. Very logical step so
right?
far.
That's a really interesting question in and of itself. Like, why do we get tired?
Yeah.
Like, why does that happen? That's a very interesting question.
We still have no idea.
Yeah, a bit of a rabbit hole too, right?
Yeah, right. It was also for the war effort. So soldiers, I mean, we're still, if you look at World War One, we're still fighting with hundreds of thousands of people in a battlefields for the most part.
It's just how conditions influence the way of thinking, too.
Right. Environmental physiology kicks in. What happens? Like a tired, thirsty, hot, this type of stuff. Mm-hmm. So you sort of move on from there. And then you have the conversion of Dr. Karpovich, however you want to say it, which is the development of Bob Hoffman, York Barbell. Right?
Oh, yeah.
Where we have, okay, you shouldn't do all this heavy stuff. It's bad for your joints. It makes you unflexible. Mm-hmm. Inflexible. I don't know, what's the word there? I don't know. One of them.
Well, immobile.
Makes
immobile.
You stiff. Yeah. Unsupple.
Right? Unsupple.
Unsupple.
Right? And then you start demonstrating, wow, you can actually be really strong, really big, and be more athletic. Mm-hmm. Wow, this is actually good. And so what happens is you've got this conversion from lifting, fatiguing exercise is no longer not bad for you. Maybe it's actually okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the
that realization was
in the
how long ago?
In the 1950s.
Okay.
Ish. This is, I mean, Bob Hoffman, York Barbell, these are the ones really pushing forward where you had these, it turns out to be researchers and scientists who were saying, yeah, this is bad for you. You shouldn't.
Almost taboo to lift weights because that would slow you down.
It's highly
it would
taboo.
Muscle bind you and make
right.
you very unathletic, prone to injury.
Yeah,
whatever.
And you have these.
And
they thought
and
smoking was good.
And certainly some percentage of the world still believes that stuff. It's still persisting with people from that generation.
Especially
but,
that it slows you down or something.
Right. We're right.
just scared they're going to lose their girlfriends. That's what's happening.
Right.
I know it is.
And so you have with these people are developing these barbell exercises and big complex movements, we start realizing, oh my gosh, they can do standing backflips with 30-pound dumbbells in their hands.
Mm-hmm.
Their performance is better.
Who can't?
Right?
I mean, come on. And get all the chicks.
So you have this next transition, right, where it's, okay, maybe this stuff's not too bad for you. The next big switch is what I like to call the Arnold Schwarzenegger effect, right? Pumping iron comes out.
Mm-hmm.
Bodybuilding starts being in the entire
popularization wave of
yeah,
this stuff.
Fitness is, and aesthetics is really the biggest transition where not only is it okay for you to lift, but now actually maybe you can look better. You can feel better about yourself. You can have the body you always wanted.
Chicks. Mm-hmm.
That's still
come everywhere all the time.
Right. It's kind of what I call the
Arnold was.
It's the evolution of bro science where it's like, let's take this highly scientific approach to weight training and weightlifting and exercising so that we can get as huge as possible as fast as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so it's the first time we've really started developing science for the purpose of aesthetic, for the purpose of I want to look better, work out better, I want more results.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to then, it was about these other classic physiology issues.
Mm-hmm.
We're cruising along good, and we still have that age is still alive right now. If you look at media, magazines, it's women, right? Here's how to get bigger butts, smaller stomachs, bigger tits. Wait, no.
And a guy,
I'm like, there's an exercise for that? Teach me.
And for guys, right? Big
and
arms,
guys,
big
the
abs.
Same fucking bodybuilding routine reprinted in every magazine from now to the end of time. Four sets of 10, everything you see here. And not very progressive
right.
all the time.
And so what's actually happening right now is you're in the middle of the next big transition, right? And that big transition is sort of multifaceted, or I should say bifaceted, in fact, where it's shifting in the direction of we're now starting to realize the major health implications.
Hmm.
Not only is it not bad for you like we used to think, okay, you can get looking good, but oh my gosh, here are the health implications of muscle.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Here are the health implications of interval training.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Here are the cardiovascular benefits of high intensity exercise. Wow. And it is completely transformed what's happening at the medical level, at the healthcare level, because we're realizing, man, maybe we should have been doing all this really hard training all along.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we talked a little about the last show, like healthier muscle being the foundation of healthier everything. Better insulin function, better communication between muscles and organs. Basically, everything that can function better, it will function better if the muscle's strong and healthy.
Yeah, one of the healthiest things you can do for yourself is to have a lot of muscle mass and have very little fat.
Right.
Like, there's very few people that have a lot of muscle mass and very low body fat percentage that are not healthy.
And you're not talking about, like, freak, crazy.
No.
Insane,
people who achieve it via natural means, training, just, and healthy lifestyle, not like massive amounts of steroids to make the muscle appear.
Right. No. Mm-hmm.
I just want to make sure that was clear for the audience.
We're not talking about a 21-year-old guy, you know, going from 10% body fat to 9% body fat. Right. We're talking about just being in a reasonable health for your age and your development area.
Yeah, if your body fat percentage is in the teens for guys, like maybe high teens, low 20s for ladies. Yeah. That's pretty lean for both genders. And then if you have a decent amount of muscle mass, where you look normal, you look athletic, you look like a, you know, between a college soccer player and a college football player, like that type of, right. of athletic build. I'm not talking about being enormous bodybuilder and being just ripped to shreds where like all your veins are sticking out or anything like that. But you know, people that have a good amount of muscle mass and a very low body fat percentage, they tend to be very, very healthy.
Right.
People that are super overweight, all of a sudden they're not healthy. They got all kinds of diseases that come with the disease of being overweight.
Right.
Right.
Exactly. And so with that, you've got a decent level of physical performance. My prediction, and I've been telling my students this, the end outcome of a degree in our field is going to be completely different in a decade. I'm predicting right now you're going to be hiring strength and conditioning coaches in hospitals. Right? You're going to be hiring them.
Word.
You're going to be getting insurance is going to start covering these types of things. It's going to happen. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen very, very soon. The entire industry will be different 10 years from now. The profession will be completely different in a decade now.
There's just no way to disregard the treatment weight, the sheer effect that a cheap – you can do this anywhere. You can have a few weights, get stronger, and really decimate these huge trends towards disease and metabolic syndrome, right. cancers, and everything else.
Yeah, and so to establish that pedigree of importance, right, so you're professionalizing the profession, right? It's getting listed and regarded in higher esteem. The second part of what I said earlier, and I said it was kind of two parts, is the level of sophistication of the research in the field. It is growing leaps and bounds where you have labs like mine where it's fairly unique. You don't have people that have the practical background that I have that have a lab like this. Mm-hmm. I have my students in here. You can see them up the wall. We've got more than 15 or so students who have been in here. They're running chemistry and molecular biology experiments, and they never had a chemistry class.
Oh, yeah.
They're strength coaches. They're working, so they'll leave an elite training center. Right, there's one in Anaheim a lot of them work at here, Stars. It's great. Mm-hmm. They're training NBA players, NFL players. They walk over here, run some chemistry experiments, go back to class, then go back and work and train a football player.
And unfortunately, it seems a little bit taboo because people go, well, these kids have certain prerequisites and this kind of other. But then again, you're ruining this sort of crossroads effect where all the magic in any area of study is where ideas and personalities and people with different backgrounds are going to mix as they're working on a topic.
Yeah,
right?
Like you said earlier, you know, we're not a bunch of – I don't have a 4.0 GPA. I barely passed one chemistry class in my life, and I run a biochemistry laboratory. Mm-hmm. All my students are the same way. Mm-hmm. So it's not you're not like, well, my gosh, science, like you said earlier. It's not like, I'm just a strength coach trying to figure out strength answers.
Yeah, it's more like on-the-job training. It's like you're learning the pieces you need to know,
sure. And
you can do those things. You didn't have to take 10 chemistry classes and learn total generic chemistry that you're never going to use.
Right.
You just came in and you learned the pieces that are important and you fucking disregard all the pieces that you're never, ever, ever going to use.
Right. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love it when I get students who have had molecular biology class and genetics class. It's super helpful.
Yeah.
Because I don't have to spend as much time training them about things that kill them in this lab, which is good. They have some basic skill.
Don't drink the formaldehyde.
Yeah.
They're going to write this down on board.
Yeah.
That doesn't go on your face.
Yeah. The bottle of ATP I have, don't eat it.
Yeah. It's not a good thing to eat.
Please don't drink that. Right. So it's really a big transition where you're going to see a lot more research that is this combination of strength and molecular. In fact, the only way you're going to answer the questions we're interested in is to start doing that type of research. And we're pretty unique in the fact that we're doing that. Mm. And we're getting some really awesome practical answers by studying this level of physiology.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, speaking of the practical answers, Andy, one of the other scientific topics we're going to bring up is heart rate and what you're learning recently with some of your evidence.
Well, as a quick example of what we talked about a little bit earlier in terms of how you use science, I was telling Doug that a couple of nights ago, Natasha and I did some intervals on the Aerodyne. Mm. So 10-minute, we did 10.
It's a couple's date. It's a romantic evening.
Yeah, right? What do they say? Like, exercise together. You know,
makes
horse together.
Train together, stay together.
Makes everything hot. Am I right, champ?
I just get yelled at the whole time. It's awful. We're not good training partners. But we did 1-minute intervals on the Aerodyne, hard as you can, 10 rounds. 1 minute on, 1 minute off.
Brutal.
Brutal, right? And I never wear a heart rate monitor, but I wore one to sort of show a point. Mm. I had an average heart rate of 195 beats per minute for the 10 trials.
Mm-hmm.
Got up to like 208.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you know what heart rate numbers mean, I just broke, like, apparently I'm 12 years old. Right? So if you don't know what that joke means, how you calculate your max heart rate is supposed to be 220
minus your age.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So technically,
test you on an exercise physiology class on your exam. Write that formula down.
Right. Yeah, that's your number, right? Mm-hmm. Well, what it's clearly showing is I'm not particularly fit. You know, I'm not like super mentally tough, and I just passed. Like, that's not how heart rate works.
Mm-hmm.
Heart rate work is some of the best in conditioning endurance athletes I've ever been around have a max heart rate of like 175.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I'm certainly not more fit than they are. But the point I'm getting at is that number, that equation, which is so well documented in science, most high schoolers know that number.
Mm.
It didn't work for me. That doesn't fit my physiology. My max heart rate's more like 212. I've been to 212 dozens of times, more. So some folks might be at 170.
Mm-hmm.
So 220 is your starting point. But you could deviate massively from that number, and that's just a very basic example of the fact that the interpersonal and intrapersonal differences are huge in science.
It's like looking in an anatomy book and you're like, wow, the human brain weighs 10 pounds.
Right.
What does that mean? It's like saying like the human foot is 8 inches long. It's like, well, maybe for somebody, but someone else's foot is twice that long. Like, it doesn't really mean anything. So the heart rate thing for you, 220 minus your age, like it should be, you know, 188 or whatever it's supposed to be. But there's a standard deviation both ways. Like for some people, it might be way less than that. Some people might be way more than that. So to your point from earlier, it's not about the average. It's about the individual. And it's everything, not just in science, but everything in the whole fucking world right now is leaning towards becoming more and more and more individualized. And science is chasing that motif, if you will.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
The heart rate facts, a very convenient thing to keep in mind if you're a student in school getting very, very frustrated over the rote, repetitive memorization of shit, and you're thinking that that's where your future lies and be able to spit back out facts versus just taking the time to understand what is the real core of why heart rate going up and down matters so much.
And there's an important point actually sort of buried in that I'm certainly not telling you to not pay attention to these normal numbers, because if you do, you're a fool. You need to know 220 minus your age. That you should start there. If you don't know that, you're going to miss the ball a lot. You're better off starting with the average and then figuring out if you're deviating. If you don't know that, if you disregard this, if you're like, well, if none of that's true for everyone, I'm just not going to learn any of it, the hell with it all, I'm just going to figure it out as I go, that is a terrible approach. You're going to make years of mistakes until you figure all these things out.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
So do pay attention to these things, but you just interpret them with a little bit of a, instead of being like, oh, that's the fact, that's the answer, there we go, it's, okay, that's pretty good, let me start there.
I think a good way of looking at it, especially now we're in a laboratory science school, I think you have to learn the basic rules of where you're playing,
yes,
and what you're doing. That's why school might not be perfect, but you learn how things have been done, and you see the landscape, and once you get that level of information, then you can decide, right, this looks weird, let me put a little pressure on that, test that. Is that true for everybody?
You can't break the myth if you don't know the myth.
Yeah, learn the rules and break the rules.
Put that on a t-shirt.
Right? Don't break the myth.
Hashtag.
Right.
So heart rate, Andy, we also talked a little bit about gaining muscle mass, hypertrophy. What's new on the scene with getting hashtag gains?
Is that a 3D printed muscle in your pocket?
I don't know.
Maybe you're just happy to see me.
People watching this going, what in the shit is in Dr. Andy's pocket? He's going to tell you.
Not quite yet, though.
Not quite yet.
Oh! Oh!
Teasing me. What is the purple thing? Go ahead, Andy.
So what I wanted to bring up here is the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, we do have a nice number of scientists out there trying to do the type of stuff where, you know, the comment I hear all the time is like, wow, these scientists, they don't understand application. Yes, we do. Some of us. And we like, no one, why doesn't anyone ever do this type of work? Well, we are. You're just not reading it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this work is
happening.
It's
an awareness thing, right?
This practical. So the example I want to bring up, I've been fortunate to collaborate with a guy. He's Facebook famous in the world of fitness, Brad Schoenfeld, out of New York. He's the hypertrophy guy, like world's guru on hypertrophy. He's a great guy. He focuses on studying.
He sounds huge.
He's tiny. He's tiny, actually.
Oh.
But he focuses only. He keeps a very focused research agenda. It is hypertrophy, and that's it, basically, right? So we've been fortunate to collaborate with him a little bit, where he's doing a bunch of different training studies looking at hypertrophy. So he'll do an 8 or 10 week training study.
Mm-hmm.
Two groups. One group will get 1 minute rest between their sets, and one will get 2 minutes.
Sure.
One will get 3 minutes. One, and he's just doing all these things where, for example, we're classically taught, if I want to hypertrophy, if I want to get gains, right, I should probably do somewhere between like 8 to 12 reps per set. Right, that's your classic textbook number.
5 to 8 sets of that.
Right, 4 to 5.
Like 80%, maybe even a little heavier, maybe a little lighter.
Maybe a little lighter, right? Well, Brad challenges all that. And he says, okay, that's actually never really been established scientifically.
Mm-hmm.
It's just funny to sound, because we've been teaching this for decades.
Right.
If you ask
this is what
us,
people do, and it just keeps persisting.
If you ask us,
it's not like it doesn't work, but we're saying, is it the best way?
Yeah, so Brad is challenging that. So he just did a couple of different studies where he finished and he looked at rep range, and he showed impressive gains in hypertrophy in that 8 to 12 rep range, but he also showed it all the way out to like 25 to 30 reps.
Mm-hmm. Ah, see, that's what people would assume is, no, you just get endurance effects from doing too many reps. Anything over 10, no, you won't get stronger.
Where here's the misinterpretation of it. He's not saying 8 to 12 is the same as 25. What he's simply saying is they both do work. Now, the 8 to 12 group or so was stronger at the end than the 25 to 30.
Mm-hmm.
So a misinterpretation of science is, they both work the same.
Right.
No, they both work the same for hypertrophy, but one of them also added these massive gains in strength.
Right. Hypertrophy means bigger muscles.
Bigger muscle, right? Getting bigger muscles. So what he will say is his interpretation of the data is different than how people interpret his own, which is always how it works, right?
Yeah.
Like every time someone interprets my research, I'm like, no.
It's like,
that is not what I said.
It's like when you hear a song, you say, oh, here's what that meant by writing the lyrics. And the guy who writes the song goes, no, man, nothing like that. You're listening to the same fucking song.
Right? And so what he says is you should spend the bulk of your training in that optimal 8 to 12 range, but then you need to also include out to 25 and include down to 5. And so he's just showing support for working across the spectrum. He's done the same thing for rest intervals. So if I do a set of 10, do I wait a minute, 2 minutes? Same thing. Most of your benefit comes with what we teach as a textbook, but you need to train over the spectrum.
Mm.
We've done the same thing in terms of, I love the question of, I want to get powerful.
Mm-hmm.
How heavy should I lift? Mm-hmm. If I lift really heavy, it's too slow, right?
Yeah.
If I lift really light, there's not enough mass for it to be powerful. Mm. And so the number coaches will throw out is like, 30%. It's a little bit of mass, right? But it's fast enough to go fast.
True. Sure, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, the collective data suggests, well, that's good, but you got to train the whole spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
You need to do some real heavy stuff. You need to do some real light stuff. Optimal power is achieved across the entire spectrum. So it's just evidence like that where there is this practical research happening. There's another guy in Florida who's doing a lot of these same type of things in elite bodybuilders.
Mm-hmm.
Right, we're trying to answer, how's it different from young, old resistance training?
Sure.
Now, what's it look like at the top end of the spectrum? So this is happening. There are some of us out there, and if I could say one thing to anyone listening, we need more people like that. We need more people who really understand practical, because Brad actually started for like 15 years, he was a personal trainer. He got his PhD like 20 years after he graduated college.
It's mm-hmm. really refreshing to hear stories like that.
Right,
people assume like, I did some personal training. Like, I can't go back and pursue an interest mm-hmm. like going to school, learning some science, learning how my muscles are actually working now that I know the application side.
Right. Most mm-hmm. of us are not scientists that learned application. Most of us are applicators.
Applicators.
Human applicators.
Practitioners. That mm-hmm. learned research because we wanted answers. So that is growing in science. We need more,
mm-hmm.
but it's getting there. The philosophy of attacking physiology from the perspective of the elite is a pretty new phenomenon, and there's only a few of us doing it.
Yeah, most of the science-y research and or developments from a lab like this went towards more like the medical system where people
healthcare.
Are sick and they're trying to get better. There's more of a, you know, there's more pain, like quite literally, like emotional, physical, and otherwise, in that situation, which tends to make people very, very motivated to get out of that pain. So kind of most of the efforts went towards the medical world first, but now people are really starting to take all those same practices and apply it towards people that are their kind of baseline normal, and they want to be as healthy as possible versus being sick, trying to get back to normal.
Yeah. I mean, the general philosophy of our lab is if we want to figure out how muscle or the body is supposed to function, instead of looking at a normal population, which generally in research, normal population means 18 to 25-year-old male who's recreationally active, whatever that means, right? And what we now realize
means you're a college kid because that's the only pool you have to pull from?
Right.
That's what the lab is?
Right. That's the easiest subject to get. What?
Condoms.
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 Absolutely.
Recreational
user.
Gotcha. Mm. And what we're now sort of, my philosophy is, that's actually, to me, closer to the end, not the spectrum of normal. That's closer to the spectrum of sick. We shouldn't be taking people who are basically physically active and can be considering that the gold standard.
Mm.
We should be taking it the other approach, which is, let's find out, let's look at the elite athletes in the world. Let's figure out what they look like, because that's where we're supposed to be. We're not trying to just get you back to not sick.
We want you to be performing in terms of life performance, health performance, at the level of these elite athletes. So our contention is, if we figure out what we're supposed to look like, then we can start getting closer to there. But if we don't know what we're supposed to look like, we don't know what we're going after.
I do like the idea of making the standards more stringent. Like, anytime you raise someone's expectations, they always gravitate towards those expectations. Anytime you lower the expectations, people just, they kind of regress to those expectations.
Absolutely.
If the recommended amount of exercise from Surgeon General, whoever recommends it, is 3 days a week for 20 minutes at a time, and they're like, you know, go for a walk around the block, then that becomes the standard. Everyone thinks like they're doing a good job if they do anywhere even close to that. Like, I think we'd have a much better time, or not much better time, but a much better outcome, rather, if we said that the standards were 5 days a week for an hour or something like that. And then I could attack that argument from a million different directions and make a case for either side, definitely. But in general, I think having higher expectations is a good thing, especially if, we're talking on the individual level.
Right. Now, we'll sort of tease it back to the last episode I was on. I think I mentioned the fact that VO2 max is one of our more significant predictors of how long you're going to live, your VO2 max. Mm-hmm. So a classic example of what you just mentioned is...
What is VO2 max for everybody who didn't watch it?
So that's sort of... it's the maximum amount of oxygen you can consume, but it's essentially how your maximal fitness. So maximal heart rate, it's very similar to that. So your maximal cardiovascular function, sort of think of it like that. So the way we normally say it is, okay, what's an average VO2 max score for a college male? And we would usually throw out a number like, well, maybe the mid to high 30s, maybe 40s, right? That's actually really low. So we say, no, like you to be healthy as a 25-year-old, you should be, everyone, in fact, the guy I used to work with, Dave Kostel, one of the classic exercise physiologists, always told us, if you're under 60, you're not trained. Mm-hmm. So 60 was him, was, don't talk to me if you're under 60. Mm-hmm. But yet we say, oh, don't worry about it. Oh, you scored a 41? No, you're good. You're normal. That's actually pretty good. And so that bar is very, very
good.
Right,
normal's
not good.
Yeah, I'm pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm doing all right.
40 for it.
I was like about to say what my score was until you were like, if you're under 60, you're untrained. I was like, maybe I shouldn't say. I've only done it once, like a true VO2 max test, but that was when we were playing college football together, like 10 years ago.
Oh, really?
And I think I got a 57.
Oh, I'm sure you're much higher.
I'm not. No. But
well,
once
I'm
I started fighting MMA,
I bet you
my score went up because I was in way better shape fighting
Doug
MMA.
Was fit. Now I got a this one number tells me otherwise. Everything I've learned to date is a lie.
I got a 50.
For a football player, that's a pretty normal number.
Yeah.
College football player.
I think 58 and a half a couple of years ago on a
Did
bike.
Did he beat you by half? You said 58?
Whatever he said, plus half. That's what I got.
I actually think, if I remember correctly, you beat me by one.
I don't know.
Just that
or I beat
fit.
You by one.
Yeah,
I don't remember.
That's probably the case. You're certainly farther down the conditioning spectrum than myself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Without a doubt. So it's we're learning a lot by studying this practical stuff, especially there are people doing this type of work. We're learning every day, and it's changing the way that we're training. They're changing the prescription a lot from what we thought, because we're doing all this really cool stuff because we have the scientific knowledge, and we're not being scared away, and we're demystifying science.
Speaking of demystification and knowledge, you're going to tell people what the hell this thing is in your pocket.
I will on episode 2 of the series. I'm just kidding. Sure. I told you we want to run the spectrum in our lab. Right?
Yeah.
So human performance, a little bit of physiology, all the way down to the nuts and bolts. So what we do is actually the muscle biopsy. So we go in with the needle. We take a chunk of people's tissue. And we pull it out. And then
you take
we start
a chunk of someone's muscle from their leg and you rip it out of their body.
Exactly.
Yes.
Basically what happens.
It's not basically. It's exactly
in
what
the name
happens.
Of science.
In the name of science. Uh-huh.
People volunteer for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They get paid like cafeteria money credits or something.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Got 50 bucks one time maybe.
Here's a free 6-pack of chicken nuggets from Chick-fil-A.
Sometimes we have a bunch of variety of protein bars we give them afterwards.
Quest bars, I'm all down.
No, that's too pricey.
May have pass biopsies.
We got the kind that got the sugar alcohol, give you the walking fart. Is that okay for your trouble?
Maybe if we did AIDS or diabetes research, we could have the funding to buy Quest bars, but we're lower than that.
You're holding in your hand. Also, use descriptives for the audio-only audience.
Right.
Yes, if you're listening to audio, by the way, you're totally missing out right now, just like the last
Andy's holding
episodes.
He's holding a pink shaft, basically.
Yeah, a pink shaft sort of with dots. So what we do is, we actually do all of our analysis at the single fiber level. Mm. So that's one muscle cell at a time.
Muscle fibers, skeletal muscle fibers in humans are extremely unique. In fact, I would encourage, I won't go into detail now, but go back and look at the write-ups that myself and my colleague Jimmy Bagley did for The Daily.
Okay.
So it's on your website, link to it. We talk a lot about the stuff we're doing here.
The new science of muscle memory.
Right. So we'll talk more about, you can read more about it there. But what we're doing is we'll go through this piece of tissue. So we rip it out of the leg, and we go through with a tweezer, and we pull out one fiber at a time. And we do all of our analysis on those fibers. So a classic thing we would look at is we would take a biopsy of Chris's leg, and we would count how many of those fibers are fast twitch and how many of them are slow twitch. Like basic type of stuff like that. Well, we're starting to get more detail because we started getting athletes, and for us that was particularly MMA fighters, where we'd put them in our human performance lab, and they'd blow the doors down in terms of their power and their strength. And then we would bring them into our conditioning stuff, and they're blowing the doors down on that. And right in our classic,
that's another thing to challenge, because you typically you wouldn't expect both things to exist at the same time, happening in MMA and also in CrossFit's happening, where people are very strong and very fit simultaneously and sort of breaking rules.
Right, and we're like, oh my gosh, textbook, you're not supposed to be able to do that. And so my question, I'm a muscle guy, and so I started thinking, like, why the hell is it happening? So we take the biopsies of these really high-level MMA and UFC fighters, and we started looking at it at the single-fiber level. So what we're doing is we're actually looking at how big the fiber is. And in human skeletal muscle, it's unlike anything else where normally most fibers in biology have one nucleus. The nucleus is what holds your DNA. It's what tells your cell to grow.
Command center of the cell.
Right, die. Well, human skeletal muscle has thousands of these nuclei in the fiber. Well, we started counting them. So we actually use a laser microscope. We make a 3D movie of individual muscle fibers.
Which is super cool.
We stain it for the actin and the myosin, which is what makes it contract.
These are basically the components that comprise a muscle cell, make it ratchet and contract and shorten and lengthen.
Right. And then we actually started staining it for those myonuclei. So those nuclei. So then what we did is we were literally leaving the laser microscope lab, which is below us, and I had this file on a flash drive, and I'm literally walking back to my office, and Jimmy said, "Hey, I just saw a sign that the library apparently has a 3D printer."
And oh, snap.
So we literally walk into the 3D printer, and I ask the guy, "What kind of files do you use?" And he tells me, and I'm like, "Really? It's the same file we have." I pull out my flash drive, I'm like, "Can you print this?" And he pops into his thing, and he's like, "Yeah, come back in an hour."
Man, I'm going to show off in front of all my colleagues when they see this fucking thing.
So what you're looking at is the result. So this is a single muscle fiber. In fact, this is actually my brother. This is a fiber. I biopsied my brother, took one of his fibers, I imaged it, and then I printed it in plaster.
That's
kind of looks like a giant nerd rope.
Yeah.
Those things are delicious.
So
thanks for the scientific comment, CTP.
You said you're going to give us some extra video, right?
Yeah.
Char Binks will put
it will
that
show
in
the
there.
Real thing, edited in.
Yeah,
all
you can see the 3D movie. You can actually just check it out on my website, too. I don't know the link. Just Google it. You'll find it.
It's on your membership site. $9.99 per month. Look at it.
Yeah.
You'll find
you have
Dr.
to be 18 or older.
You might find his porn video from 20 years ago. You might find science. Who knows what you find?
I forgot you did that.
Andy Galpin.
So some of the interesting things about this is if you see the black sort of dots.
Yes.
If you're listening to audio, pause.
There are
the
black
video.
Dots.
Right.
For the audio.
Many, many.
These are the nuclei. And so what we're actually able to do is count how many nuclei you have. Now, Chris, as the astute former scientist and strength coach you are.
I was a former scientist.
If you have a bunch of nuclei, what's that matter?
I would think that there's a lot more communication and handling of information than otherwise would be going on.
Absolutely. So in terms of training, if I have more nuclei, I can do things like recover better. Right, because I have more control center, I can do different types of training and get better responses because I have more regulation.
And a more coordinated effort to do these things that need to get done.
Exactly. Things are more efficient. Recovery happens faster. All this stuff. And so I wasn't really surprised when we started to find these MMA fighters just simply started having more of these myonuclei.
Than Casey does, your brother?
Yeah, yeah. Well,
nothing.
He's right. Working on it. His brother's working on it.
Right. So was also what and it actually gets hyper-detailed past this. Doug and I were talking about some of the stuff earlier, but even the shape of the nuclei, you can see some of them are circular, like that.
Sure, yeah.
Nice circle.
Some are long.
Right? Some of them
squiggly.
Are long. That all means something, right? The shape of them. We talked about the location. So this image doesn't show it, but you got to realize that some of these nuclei are on the outside, and the movie will show this well. Some of them are in the middle. What we know now is when the nuclei start going to the middle, the fiber is about to die. Yeah. We don't know why that's happening, but we know that that's a relationship. Young, old, strength trained, non-strength trained, this is all different. So the actions are different in them. So what we're trying to do is figure out, again, what makes these elite-level athletes different. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to see it at this single fiber, single cell level.
So the more nuclei are becoming present, you're observing that. And then also I think what's interesting is when these athletes have a period of detraining, they go away. Are you observing any kind of effect when they are going away, they're not training, they're getting a change, and they come back to training? What happens because of all these nuclei?
Let me bring out my model again. Okay, now, it's a classic idea of muscle memory. So if I were to do a gain phase, right, if I joined a six-month muscle challenge, right?
You should, because this is Jack is very loose on you.
Wow.
Come on.
Wow, you're in my lab.
I'm in your lab. I'm calling you Gainsless.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Just joking, Andy. Come
so on. If you were to do a bunch of training, this fiber would get thicker. Okay, it gets bigger. Well, that's a problem because each one of these nuclei can only control so much. Are you guys worried about the thickness of my doll here?
It's just
production crew, come on. Keep it together.
Charlotte's giggling behind you.
It looks bad.
I love it when Charlotte giggles behind me.
Hey-o.
So each one of these nuclei can only control a certain amount of area. Analogy, if you were to start a company and you're expanding across the globe, you'd eventually have to open up new offices everywhere to control
get a bunch
everything.
Of new managers.
Right. Well, you do that, and that's what happens. And so your fiber gets bigger, thicker, the diameter goes out, and so you end up having satellite cells come in. Those get developed into new nuclei. Mm. Cool. You stop training. The fiber shrinks, goes back to the normal size. Well, the old theory would be that the nuclei then die.
Because
that would
be like a waste of resource. And
right. What we're now thinking is that they actually stay alive for quite some time, so that when you start training again, those are already in place, so it's easier for you to come back to that space.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So back to your business analogy. So if your company grew and expanded across the globe, you open more offices, more offices, more offices, you hire more managers, more managers, more managers, and then you downsize, you start laying off employees, but what you didn't do is you didn't sell all your buildings and you didn't fire your managers. You still have that core team. That way, if business picks back up, you have all that infrastructure in place and you can grow big again very quickly.
100%. You get rid of the interns, you get rid of the low-hanging ones, and then you downsize a little bit, but you keep the important players.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can bring the other ones back to bring it back
out.
That's
a super important point to make, is if you get hurt, you get something happen in your life where you're making good progress, and now progress stops because of circumstances in your life that aren't allowing you to train, aren't allowing you to recover what you want. If you have to take a break, or if you take a break on purpose after a few competitions, you need some rest, you can come back way quicker and better than you think. You won't like magically just lose all this progress. Sort of the infrastructure is there to help you come back fast and probably better than before if you have a reasonable training program, right?
Yeah, 100%. We have another study actually launching here really soon that I'm really excited about, where some folks, if you know much about this, you might be thinking, how much of that is actually pre-genetically determined versus how much of it did you get when you trained?
Sure.
So we were lucky. We're very fortunate. We have a set of identical monozygous twins. So exact same DNA.
Is it the Olsen twins?
No.
That'd be cool, though, right?
It would be cool, bro.
Right. So identical twins, same DNA. One of them has about 30 years of marathons, Ironmans, endurance events. The other one has never exercised.
Oh, man.
Mm-hmm. So we
like
literally,
the dream scenario.
Literally have the best design study you can imagine. Exact same starting DNA, 30 years of consistent training. We're going to bring him in. We're putting him through a whole physiological gamut of testing, biopsies, all this stuff included. We're going to figure out, essentially, we know that basically everything is trainable. The question is how much.
Mm-hmm.
So, right, if you're naturally born, say, for example, your genetics would give you a higher VO2 max than Chris, right? Mm. Well, we think currently VO2 max, you got about a 20 or so percent ability to change.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but we're going to find out exactly. Is it 20? Is it 15? Is it 80? If the trained twin has got a double VO2 max,
right,
trainability is a lot higher than we
and
think.
Those are the results that'll get you published on the front cover of fucking Nature magazine.
You know why it won't? Because we've got a subject size of 1.
But as we've learned on this show, and that's not necessarily strength. A bad thing. It's very insightful to have meaningful evidence from a very small experiment size.
I'm very fortunate working here because I don't have a lot of that pressure we talked about earlier in terms of publication. So I'm really fortunate. Lee Brown, the director of the lab, is also our director of his lab. He's not my boss, but we care about doing awesome shit. If that means more publications, cool, fine. If it doesn't, I don't care. I want an awesome answer. I like MMA. I like fighting. I like this stuff. I want that answer. If it means I get published, cool. If it means I don't care. I want to know the answer.
What advice would you give to the aspiring science students and aspiring coaches and athletes out there, Andy, if they want to learn a little bit more about sciencey stuff, where would you even start?
Okay, so I'm actually going to go a little bit big picture here.
Go big picture.
And I'm going to force you to go back to episode 189, the one you did with Alex Macklin recently.
Okay.
Knowing versus learning?
What's it? Learning versus knowing.
No, mm-hmm. Knowing versus learning.
Okay, right. So here's what be a learner, don't be a knower. So when you hear these things happen, when, for example, someone has an idea and they tell you this training program's great or this supplement's great or you should do this or foam roll or you shouldn't do this, I really encourage young coaches to step back and instead of being like, no, bro, I saw a paper show that didn't work, what you need to say is, wow, I wonder why they're doing that that way. I wonder how it's working. So, in fact, ever since that that meeting we had where we had this talk, I've had an entire new approach where every time something happens in my life, the first thing I try to do is, okay, I immediately want to criticize something. I play a game where try to figure out as fast as you can a reason why that person did that. Mm-hmm. So whether it's training stuff or whether it's something like, you know, I went down to the kitchen this morning and my brother didn't do his dishes, didn't clean his pan. My gut reaction was like, you motherfucker. Like, you know,
every
how
day
could you
with
inconvenience
you?
Me so much?
Right? And so I, instead of doing that, I go, okay, and this is a conscious act. I go, all right, try to envision some reasons why he may have done that. Mm. Turns out he did that because my bedroom doesn't have a door. It's in the loft, and the kitchen's kind of below. Mm. So for him to clean it, he was going to have to bang things around. This is 3:45 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
So he didn't clean the dishes so that he wouldn't wake me up.
Convenient.
Mm. Had I yelled at him, I'd have felt like a giant asshole.
Right.
Right. And so the same thing happens with training, all this stuff. So when someone says, I'm doing this approach or I'm doing this movement, I like to do this variation. Instead of being like, no, dude, I saw on Technique Wad, you're an idiot. Don't do it that way. Try to go, I want to think of three different reasons why he might be doing it that way.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing when young coaches read science, right? This thing worked. This thing didn't work. Well, okay, maybe it worked, but try to think of another scenario when it may not work. So this may have worked for hypertrophy. I wonder if what happened to strength? What happened to speed? What happened to recovery? What happened at this level? Getting lost in the conclusion of science can be traumatic. It can be a terrible approach. So my young coach, my advice to them, when you're in class, when you're listening to audio or podcasts, whenever you're doing, when you're in the gym, try to have that approach and really don't think about, is this working, yes or no? And just think about, I wonder why. Give me three reasons right now why someone might want to do that. Now, you can still disagree, but you've gained so much more perspective, and you won't sound stupid when you say something to somebody who's a scientist like, oh, this has been shown to not work. And I'm like, really? Because I could play that game all day.
Yeah, that's an amazing mindset to cultivate. And what about people who want to get in touch with Andy, learn more about what you're up to, come visit you, track you on social media? Where can they find you?
Yeah, email chris@barbellshrug.com.
Oh, no!
I'm just kidding. The social media stuff, at Dr. Andy Galpin, so like doctor, but not spelled out.
Mm-hmm.
You can do there. Check out our lab. You'll have to just Google my name and Google our lab. It'll pop up. Or you can
put a link in the show notes to how you could get a hold of Andy here at Cal State Fullerton.
On our Instagram page, every time we finish a study, it gets down there. Every time I find an interesting study, I throw it up on there. I will link as much as I can. I know the links don't work very well on Instagram. People always ask me to put it in my bio. I'm not putting all the links in my bio. Just Google the damn title. It comes up. So things like that.
And hopefully in the very near future, we are going to be, after much, many, many meetings and a whole lot of work, we are finally going to be getting Barbell University off the ground one of these days. We firmly believe that education for the science of exercise physiology and how that applies to real training is not as good as it should be. We can't find anyone that's doing it as well as we think it needs to be done, so we're taking that into our own hands, and we're going to be opening that probably not by the end of this year. Might do some pilot courses or something like that, but we're flying in a choice member of the team from Australia to live here in San Diego, who will be helping me and Andy run that that new university. So look out for barbelluniversity.com.
Barbell University. In fact, there's already some stuff up there. There'll be more coming.
Mm-hmm.
It's we could talk a lot about that, but it's really a couple of things I want to emphasize on Barbell University. It is a completely different change in content. So it is content-driven in terms of you're not going to get the same information in your four-year college degree that you're going to get in Barbell University, and it will not be delivered in the same fashion you've ever seen it delivered. So delivery and content will be completely different. I couldn't be more excited about that project. It's going
to
be awesome.
Again, we're just working to push the evolution of what we know forward, right?
Well, it's sort of silly, but it's sort of actually like getting up with the times. We're finally catching up with what you should be getting in a college
degree.
Updating
the mechanism by which you can learn and get involved and be a part of it.
Actually, on that note, if someone wants to be involved with Barbell University, definitely reach out to us. We're looking for people that potentially might want to teach courses someday down the line, or that just think that's a fucking cool idea and you just want to be involved. Just connect with us. More likely, connect with Andy. Where should they reach out to you?
Andy@barbellshrugged.com.
Perfect.
Yeah, that's the best email.
I was hoping you were going to give your current university address.
You can do that too, but that inbox tends to get very thick very fast.
He ain't checking through there. People are asking about midterms and my question about my grade, all this
stuff. Now, I believe my track record is 100% in Barbell Shrugged fan emails being returned.
Positive.
Damn. Returned. I have returned every single email I've got, which has been a lot. Some of them are very ridiculous, like, you know, I'm currently an engineer, but I want to change fields. What should I do?
Just tell me.
I don't know.
I got my pen and pad ready, man.
Be awesome.
But you answered.
I don't know. Yeah, I always answer.
You're the man.
Sounds like you know a lot about engineering. Yeah, right. Doing that.
Like I said, if you have those questions, email ctp@bar.
Well, we're here to help.
Yeah.
I'll wrap it up there. Ladies and gentlemen, a very fun sciencey show. For more information, go to barbellshrugged.com. Sign up for the newsletter. We'll keep you up to date on all cool things like Barbell University and the future shows we got coming out.
Yeah.
Also, go to iTunes, Stitcher, and whatnot. Wherever you listen to the show, leave us a positive comment if you think we deserve it. Of course we do. And hell, we'll see you next time, man. Cheers, everybody.
Peace.
Join the conversation every week after the episode over at barbellshrugged.com. This is also where you'll find new episodes of Barbell Shrugged, Technique Wad, Nuggets and Pearls, Barbell Business, Get Change, plus new articles every day on our daily blog, written by us, guests of the show, and some of the biggest names in strength and conditioning. So, go there and leave a comment now.
Oh my gosh, wow, that's so cool. Yay, that's so awesome.
Did you like this video? If so, subscribe to our channel and share this with your friends.
And if you want even more free, awesome resources to help you reach your fitness goals, plus some updates that we only share over email, head over to barbellshrugged.com and sign up for the newsletter.